Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to STABcast, the Sunsphere Tactical Attack Brigade Star Wars Legion podcast. I'm Tim, super-tuned Hannon, with Will, is that all you got, Heim? Ryan, over-tuned Swoski, and Ben, the untouched Fowler. How's everyone doing
so
this morning?
Lonely.
Over. So over-tuned, really?
Over-tuned.
Rebels, over-tuned?
You're okay, flying pal. Into that over-tuned category for me.
Okay, buddy. we'll get to you.
I feel fine about everything, really.
This week on the STABcast, all the rules changes we have wanted and more than we thought we would actually get.
To start, though, before we get into all that fun stuff, battle reports. I don't think I have one.
Does that mean I've actually played more games than Tim in the past week?
Whoa.
In the past week, absolutely. Ooh. Yeah, because I missed last week. Ooh.
I played two games and an imaginary one.
And was that one of your dream matches?
No, that was the fake game we played at the beginning of our playtest yesterday.
So, anyway, what do you guys got?
So we were doing some playtesting on the LVO piece. Yep. Trying some games out, some odd list building. So the games I played were real games.
Right.
They had some odd list-deriving components, so they weren't optimized by any imagination. But I played Imperials twice yesterday.
They're actually designed to be not optimized, which makes it makes it fun.
And were they really games? They were against Brett and Keith.
Hold on. Those are both very good players.
Yeah, but they're going to be full of nonsense.
Yeah, that's true.
But, you know, with the list full of nonsense and those players also full of nonsense,
Ryan,
it was very fitting.
Ryan, those are not both good players. Those are both enemies of the STABcast.
And good players.
And good players.
That's how you earn your stripes as an enemy.
That's right. Just being better than us, which isn't much. So
I will say that, of course, because of the way with the random, not random, the list making, we'll talk about when we get to LVA a little bit closer. Yeah. But basically, Keith brought against me two sets of Tauntauns. So immediately I cried foul. And then, you know, he rolled decent amounts of dice. I cried foul again.
There was much
whining. Will asked that I be removed from the room. So for my crying of the foul.
I wanted a partition to stop hearing all of the whining from across the hall.
It was pretty bad.
Tauntauns touched me a long time ago. They have scarred me deep in my soul.
Neat.
It is
you're fine.
Post-traumatic stress Tauntaun disease.
This is when I'd say, do you want to talk about it? But I don't want you to talk about
exactly.
it.
Exactly.
Will, what do you got?
Good games against Keith.
That's fine.
I got to play the Imperials with your boys. I've not put out of the box in quite some time.
Yeah.
So the only downside of yesterday was I had to use Tim's monstrous Dio bot. It's got Aiden's head on top of it.
You love him.
No.
He's a blessing. No one loved him.
Did you also use Tim's hostage with the little arms?
Yes. I made Brett use the hostage with the little arms.
I have the big arm one here on my desk just to remind me of my failures.
Oh, we were looking for the other one.
Yeah, we were looking for that one.
It stares at me, judgingly.
We end up using Darth Jar Jar as the other hostage, so.
Oh, I should have given you my statues. I had the Jar Jar statues, Gungan statues.
So yeah, I had a lot of fun. Like I said, I got to play some Imperials, which means I'm going to be informed for our later conversation.
Nice.
Will, what'd you play this week? There wasn't one of our matches.
Right. I was also involved yesterday and have Imperial context for what it's worth. Still hate it. but before the day before our sweet update, I did play a game versus Keith. Over at Sci-Fi City, just a Wednesday night game.
Ooh, the old points?
Nice. Yeah.
Yes, the old way.
The old ways.
The classic. It's vintage now. It's a vintage game.
That's right.
I don't quite know what Keith's list would cost him now, but I think it'd be about the same since he had a lot of Mandos.
Yeah, I believe he talked about it, I think he shared on our local Facebook group that it was about the same, or some of the stuff actually went down, so it was cheaper now, which made me cry. Well, but
his list was Leia, Sabine, 3 core, 3 Mandos, R2-3PO.
I hate it.
Yeah, thanks. I hate this. Move on.
Yep.
So any points he saved on his core troopers would go up in R2. So yeah, it probably did stay about the same.
And he didn't even have like the dark saber. So no dark saber. Sabine was a bad time for him. but my list went from 796 to 811.
Okay.
So
not a huge swing.
Things are fine.
15 grand points.
But some thoughtful cuts you might have to make if you want to play it again.
Right.
All those essays.
I was running...
You son of a bitch.
I was running Obi-Wan, Padme R2, 4-core, double arc. One of them was a strike team.
Also hate it.
I know, Ben.
This is another thing I hate. Yes, moving.
Basically, Obi-Wan decided to kill like 9 Mandalorians. It was a great time.
As he does,
One of them was Sabine. It was a good old time. It was actually really close, though. We were playing boxes, and I had to infiltrate Padme to have any hope of surviving. Okay. And then she ate 3 rocket barrages, as Mandos do. Mm-hmm. And with her dying breath, she passed the box to R2, and he skittled off with it.
Now, hang on. According to Keith, and this is a message he sent me on the day of, Padme, round 1, dead in 4 activations.
Yes. 3 Leia like, and 3 Mandos. On the 4th
activation. Yes.
It was a thing, but otherwise I knew all those Mandos would be double moving onto the middle box and just waving their one finger salutes at me.
As I lean on my cane of my old age and infiltrate superiority with my amount of wisdom that I've gained, watching all these new factions learn how to infiltrate is hilarious. I can't tell you how many in the past couple weeks I've seen either Padme's or ISF's or Ben's Cad Bane just immediately explode.
Yep. Ben doesn't play Cad Bane.
Well, he did once, and he immediately exploded.
That's fair.
That's why you don't.
I did it once.
That's why you don't use infiltrate, kids.
Right. Just ignore that.
That's as an Imperial man. That's my best way to learn. Is that a new thing? A new way to play this game?
I don't.
Screw that. No, not at all.
I'm pretty sure if you listen to episode 59, we did lament on the Imperial mindset of, is that something new? I shan't take it.
No, I shall ignore that. More shores, please. Delicious. Now, oh, boo-hoo. Again,
I only have this verification because Keith texted me during your game. It looks like at some point Will pulled Will dice and rolled tons of crits in black dice and 4 hits in white dice at Clan Wren. What happened, Will?
They got blocked.
Well, when you spend your aims, you're not supposed to just automatically turn them to hits. You're supposed to actually reroll
that's,
them.
That's marksman. That's what me and Tim get to do.
Right.
I can't help what the dice do once they leave my hand.
Once they leave my hand, hit my magnetized tray with my magnetized dice. It's just weird. It's just, I can't control that.
Magic hands. Yeah.
Why would you speak these lies of me? Do I look like Brandon?
Oh, we love you, Brandon. We're just been known to have
the magic touch. He's been accused by a couple store owners of rolling dice incorrectly.
Yep. That was funny.
That was just pure salt, though. It was nothing about my dice throwing.
I remember that.
And it was the store manager because he was also playing in the event. Not
yes,
not just playing me. Walking around accusing Will of cheating.
He was playing me and losing and getting mad.
Will's former boss, Frank, has accused him of cheating multiple times. Just well, by I mean,
that's,
by. So.
That's usual for him.
Yeah, but I mean, Clan Wren blocked everything. So you're like, oh, Mandos, those seem also overpowered.
Not really.
Is there a way that both your lists could have lost that match?
Do what?
That's really what I... Is there a way that both of your lists could have lost that match? No. In that case, I'm not going to pay any more attention to it.
It did come right down to it, though. I had 3 boxes, but one of them was held by a squad that was very diminished by Clan Wren just shooting him all day long. And so I had to like run another squad up to hold it. Like he didn't drop it, but it's like, whenever you drop this, my hands are on it for when you die. And it came down to some Obi-Wan Guardians and some red saves, but I did pull it out. It was a fun match.
Well done. Beating Keith is no easy task, as half of the podcast can tell you.
He's good. He's a very good player.
He is a good player. So, Ryan, you got to play at least a match, because Keith had to leave on Saturday.
Yep, Keith had to leave. Keith came out and helped us play test the LVO narrative event, Battle for the Midrim. Tickets on sale now. Or I guess we're all waitlisted now, but
sold out, yeah.
Right.
So, we've been messing around with that, and so I took over. It's supposed to be a 4-on-4 kind of team event. And as we didn't have 8 playtesters, we kind of set aside resources for the two people not playing to use. And when Keith had to leave, I set his army aside and wanted to see what they had left one of the other, you know, commanders. And the list that I was able to cobble together, beauty is really in the eye of the bag holder. And I played up against Will. We played... if you go back to our Christmas episode, we played the scenario that Ben designed of a propaganda war, where we're putting up punk rock posters and then tearing each other's punk rock posters down.
It was interesting.
Yeah, my command bag ended up being 5 core units, and then exactly 1 of every other token. So I had 3 rebel troopers, a vet, a Mark II, a set of Tons, an X-34 land speeder, Sabine, and my commander. What was my special forces unit? A naked, no upgrades, no heavy weapon, rebel commando squad.
So just 4 commandos.
Just 4 dudes. It was certainly a list. Now, because of these same similar restrictions, Will's list was also kind of all over the place.
It was.
He was running, you were running our Imperial kind of stormtroopery commander who has coordinate and steady with Dio and Boba Fett.
And Boba, yeah.
3 sets of bikes, and then a smattering of just random stormtrooper bros.
I love it.
Yeah, 3 stormtroopers. One had a T-21, one had a medbot, one had nothing.
Yes.
A sniper strike team, and 3 guards.
And yeah, just 3.
No stick friend, just 3 of them.
Love it.
So it was actually a pretty terrifying list. Except for the first 2 turns, just did not want to go your way.
No. No, they did not.
Now that the speeder keyword has been changed, and we'll get to that, and bikes are now cheaper and Imperial options are opening up. Dear speeder bike players, keep your bikes together and hammer a single target. Will kind of split his bikes all over the place so I could kind of piecemeal them out.
Like a fucking
and then
bitch.
He put.
I thought 2 bikes could kill a 4 hit point model, but nope.
Nope.
Yeah. I mean, you're right to have suspected that was a thing you could have done, but.
Since they could just compulsory aim shoot it, but nope.
Well, I mean, I had heavy cover, nimble, and a dodge token, so.
Well, you didn't have those at first, then you did, but fine. Yeah. But then rebels happened, and wait, where's this elf come? Oh, I just have that. Okay.
It's a thing I do. And then I loved the place that you put Boba. Boba kind of perched onto this building. And it was very much a place where I would imagine a clone player to put a strike team that's just going to sit and use everyone's tokens and just rain death from. Or maybe not even an arc strike team, but a full arc team.
Oh, full arc right there. Your whole army would have been dead.
Yeah, exactly. And so Boba kind of chills up there, but Boba doesn't have the firepower of a full arc strike team. How did it feel, Will, to roll a normal amount of dice again?
Felt terrible.
Welcome to the little leagues.
Welcome to the rest of us.
Well, right. It wouldn't have felt so terrible if I had a list that I'd built and had other options in it, but it was right. I had 4 activations that could deal damage and then a bunch of limp noodle stormtroopers that are just here's 4 white dice, but then those were usually the ones that worked best.
Yeah, yep. That crit actually dice. Was remarkably
funny.
That's
what we call those, are crit dice.
Yeah, it really feels like the white attack die has more crits on it than the other dice.
Well, I mean, it's more likely to roll crits than
put
than
your math away
dice when they hit.
Yes,
a higher percentage of your hits are crits. But yeah,
but we know this from mortars that there's 2 crits printed on every die.
True. I don't understand how that works with mortars. Every time it's 3 crits. What? What do you do in mortars?
Just there's the first crit, and we'll aim the other 2 dice, and whoop, there's another one. How does that happen?
It just does. It just does.
But Boba's 4 black dice, even with his sharp 2, were just.
I think Boba went in hard and early for my commander. And I think you need a, I don't know. Boba's good at finding those softer targets, and she was
on 1 wound, Ryan.
She was on 1 wound. You're right.
That's a soft target.
But then you found a darksaber to the face, and I managed to Sabine managed with explosions to kill every Mandalorian on the table, including herself.
Yes.
And
I mean, that's about how Mandalorian Civil Wars go.
Yeah.
Yep.
I mean, that's about how that works.
Will's bike defense dice rolled surprisingly well.
They do that sometimes.
Oh.
They still died, but they did roll better.
They did still die.
Right, but they died on your terms. It's fine.
Your commander and your guards who were keeping your commander alive just decided not to throw any blocks whatsoever.
The bikes rolled better than them, yeah.
I took a Z6 squad and just unloaded 5 black dice, 6 white dice with no tokens, and I think I got 7 hits, which like 5 of went through or something ridiculous like that.
I Guardian 2, the commander rolled 4, and then all those wounds went onto models.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you blocked like 1. It was really sad.
Yeah.
It was a really fun game. We were playing a bunch of stuff that we weren't used to, but I think for me personally, and I don't know how Will felt about this, the standout big damn hero was that X-34. Just zip-zopping and zooping around. I found a nice little alleyway in our map where he didn't have a ton of presence, and the presence he did have there didn't really have a reliable way to damage it.
Most of my list didn't have a reliable way to damage it, but yeah.
Yeah, and I found some nice soft spots and blew a bunch of people up with a rocket launcher, and it was a great deal of fun.
It was something.
Will helped me out a bunch because I think it was twice I went to move my speeder, and now with the rules change, I don't have to move it first. I can shoot before I compulsory.
Yeah, and I just look at him and go, why are you moving? You have a great shot lined up.
I'm like, by God, I do have a great shot lined up. But it was a fun game. Yeah, we had a lot of fun putting up propaganda posters and tearing them down.
Shooting them down.
If Will's surprisingly good speeder dice are any indication, on my table playing against Brett, the Gav tank rolled 9 surging blocks.
Yes.
9. Excellent. I never rolled a block with the Gav tank. What got surges through the armor hit every time. I healed my tank twice. Yep. I did happen to have an astromech floating around. And nope, still died. 9 surging block dice.
Yep.
In a row.
I just understand.
Bunk, 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 bunk.
I understand. And I imagine Will, or excuse me, Brett was shooting you in the side arcs with his T-47, giving it an impact 4.
No. Oh. No. No, he actually wasn't.
Oh, okay.
That's the thing.
Yep.
No, that came from Chewbacca.
Yep.
That came from that random before. Z6.
Mm.
Just
That impact 1, pierce 1, so delicious.
My game against Brett. I'm playing with the HH12 again. The list making is supposed to bring out the odd and interesting things we tend not to play. So I had 4 stormtroopers, each with a thing like a DLT. One had the astromech. One had the RT-97, and one had the HH12. Rocket launcher. Let me remind you, dear listeners, it's still bad. Don't take it. It's not good.
It's fine.
I did have 2 E-webs, a dewback, the tank, and a full set of scout snipers and an IRG.
Of all the lists that we had to cobble together, I will say yours was probably the most thoughtfully put together.
Yes.
Like you had a cohesive idea behind your list.
What to try to pull the thing together with, yeah. So, yeah, but it was a lot of fun. Look forward to more conversations about what the LVO narrative event's going to hold.
Yes.
In the off chance that LVO is still happening.
Right.
COVID notwithstanding. Right. But yes. Right. I mean, so be sure to check out our Instagram. I think Will took a couple pictures of some tables. I meant to and just forgot. I actually had planned on bringing the GoPro. I was going to set the table. I like the setup. Our local game store has this nice little patio bit where you can, rent for $5, but they give you a $5 gift card for having done so. And we had a great space, great time, beautiful outside with the light and then, good temperatures. It was nice. It was very, very nice. So check out the Instagram of those pictures when Will posts them.
Yeah, I'll have those up.
STABcast.
I'll have those up here before this goes live. But also check us out on Facebook and Twitter. Give us a rating on your listening platform of choice. iTunes, Spotify, Google Podcasts. Apparently that's a thing.
Why do you say that's a thing? It's Google. It's like the 4th biggest company in the world.
Yeah, but nobody uses the Google whatever apps that come on your phone. You get other stuff that does it better than that.
Hey, Ben, where do you listen to your podcast, Ben?
I actually listen on Spotify and listen on Google. Google's okay. Where I download our podcast. This is where I download most of them. There's some things are Spotify only, so...
You know what nothing is? Podbean only, because that's trash.
Well, Podbean sends it out to all the places.
Yeah, so Podbean thanks, is Podbean. Let's not diss the Podbean.
Yeah. Podbean gives us server space, so
I don't like
that.
Their UI. I want a better UI. That's all.
Well,
I
you don't reuse it, so it's fine.
That's why I don't use it. But anyway. We're also on the Discords, the Legion Discords. We are
and sure others.
At our name, I guess, STABcast, our name, except for me, everyone has value somehow still is my name.
Yeah, but if you type in STABcast Tim, it'll show up.
Yeah, STABcast Tim should show up, or Temptation Irish, one of those two. But yes, we're on all of their various services. There's been whispers of Invader League starting soon. Woohoo!
I will say when the points drop happened, it was moving so quickly, I was getting the time delay.
Yes. They had to slow it down when everything dropped.
Too much trading was happening. I thought the trading floor would be stopped.
No, it should have been slowed down.
Yeah. Selgar by Empire.
That really wasn't happening, but you know, it was
right.
There was a rally in Empire stock, but Garstock was holding steady.
That's right. There was a slight dip due to some fears, but they've leveled out now.
Well, okay. All the fair weather Gar players may have fled, which will be
that's
fine.
That's right.
I mean, that's probably true. I mean,
your I can't weather's always
standbys
fair.
Anymore.
Buy speeder.
Yeah. Oh, man. Don't.
Yeah, you can check out our. You can also email us at swstabcast@gmail.com. If you are sending us lists, everyone has decided to do that over the past 2 weeks.
Yeah.
God bless y'all. We don't have that much time to play Legion, so when I get to play, I'm gonna try to pick some of the tastier morsels. The range 2 only list that I was sent, wouldn't hold my breath. I mean, maybe we'll see.
What about the 6 activation list that somebody sent? Will?
Yeah,
I want to see that actually. I'll play my range 2 list against that.
My Anakin Obi-Wan 4 core list or whatever. It was.
I'll play my range 2 list against that. That's fine. We can see if we can make that happen.
Uh
huh.
You'll die before you get there because the core.
Yeah.
Then I'll see you in hell.
So, but you guys can also send us things you want us to discuss or our thoughts on. We'd love to hear that kind of stuff. And you can check out our t-shirt store to help keep the servers running at teespring.com/store/stabcast. We have some new merch with our new logo that we have thrown up over the Hooray. Past couple weeks.
Yes.
And those of you who have gone and bought some of that product, kudos to y'all. It really truly does help.
Yes. Thank you for that.
We appreciate you.
Shout out to that too. I've had several people send me pictures of the various colors, and so far all of them look good. Everything looks solid.
Nice. Alpaz, we're still working on the onesie.
We are. I'm actively working on a onesie.
It's in research and development.
So, Al, send me your measurements.
Oh, that seems a little weird. I don't know. I mean, I know you've met us in real life a couple times. But,
Ryan just wants to know. It's not for the onesie.
Exactly. It's for this doll he's building in his basement.
Yeah.
Hey, after you spend a night on the floor in St. Louis with me and Jay Muth, you learn some things.
You never go to the floor.
I hope it was about Legion.
It was. We actually talked about Legion. Yep.
I mean, we've talked about Street Legion before, but that's a different.
That's Sheet Legion.
Sheet Legion. Bravo, Will.
Well done, sir. Well done.
Bravo, bravo. I mean,
rolling blanks.
You know, we're a free love podcast. You know, you do you. You do your
business.
Yeah.
With gusto.
No bother. With gusto. I mean, as long as
speaking of gusto, the news.
The news.
Save us.
So before the points change and the RRG update, in fact, the RRG update was so big, it's now the 2.0 RRG update.
Whoa.
We got an entirely different set of news, which did set the Legion world a tumble.
Yes.
Yeah.
And did
our new overlords.
It also put the RRG and everything in question, so there was a little bit of fear in there initially.
Yeah, there was. I was like, Will's hot take of the RRG never happening actually coming.
Yeah. Oh my God, that was so accurate for a second there. We're a little concerned. We'll worry.
Very, very concerned. So FFG Asmodee dropped the news that its Star Wars minis projects are moving to Atomic Mass Games, which makes the Marvel Crisis Protocol game.
Right. Yep.
Which looks beautiful. It's a game I tested at Gen Con last year, had a lot of fun with. Will's got some models. I mean, they are fantastic.
Gen Con, I got to meet some of the sculpting and art team, which is really cool, and talk to them for a little while about them and their game. So it's definitely bittersweet, I guess, to see it leave FFG, because we've played FFG games for... I mean, that's how I met Ben on the FFG message boards. Like, I know you're not supposed to talk to strangers on the internet, but a podcast came out of it, so...
But we did. I mean, we did, absolutely. Yeah. So it's going to be... Yeah, it was definitely one of those things like, oh, there's some real concern there. What does this mean? What's this going to happen for?
Right.
There had been a shakeup at the company. Some people who used to work there that we've met... several times that we shook hands with, had conversations about the beautiful games they produced for us, no longer work for the company in a way, and that happened. And so literally like Wednesday when our podcast released from last week, we're like, oh, what's going to happen?
Exactly.
And then it's like, okay, it's all doom and gloom. There's a healthy amount of stress because this is the game that we go out for now.
Yep.
X-Wing was the game that took us to Atlanta to see all those people, to meet the Birmingham folk, to we spread our gameplay across the region and loved it. We met people in Chicago because of it, and Legion was that game for us now. So if we're transitioning, what's that mean for parts of it? It's our social life. What's that mean for us as a group? Because we don't.
Yeah.
I don't see Dio now. They don't play X-Wing. Yeah. Right? I love Birmingham. I don't see Charlie unless I'm playing X-Wing.
Right.
So what do we do? Like I, that, so there's a real strong, heavy, you know, anxiety about that. And, you know, COVID and you know, the U.S. election and all Thanksgiving coming up and all that other stuff that also gets in your way.
And I think that's a lot of my anxiety.
It's a stress.
I think overall this could hear me say it, this could be very good, but it's a lot of anxiety because it's like you said, it's not just this game we play. Like there's a whole, this maybe sounds a bit cliche or weird, but it's like a whole lifestyle around it. Like it's a whole, you buy the minis, you paint the minis, you talk about the minis. My God, we talk about the minis every other week and all these other things.
This is episode 60 of us talking about the minis.
Right. We talk about the minis every day.
Right, like. Exactly. So it's,
and
it's
some people think we're worth listening to.
That's right. So it's just, it's what we do with our free time. And so now it's, especially like you said, right now in COVID time, like our free time is very precious and very important. And to have that jeopardized is core shaking. But again, I think there can be some positives to it. Like you said, like I'm definitely going to miss like Alex and stuff. Like Alex Davey was my favorite, my person, favorite dev that I've met. How about that? Because I never met Luke. Yes. So I can say that.
But this is true. Luke Eddy was the one you were like, I don't know who that man is. And I was like, Tim, he's the other designer of this game.
He likes my tweets. That's what I know. That's it. Yeah. which then actually stopped after that episode. No joke, but that's fine. But no, I mean, Alex is a fun guy. I got to cast a couple games at LVO with him. And it was a highlight of my nerd career. Because it was just very down to earth, so that part really sucks. But again, as far as the overall picture, I think it could be good. It's just a lot of unknown right now in a world of lots of unknown already.
So we know that Atomic Mass Games is run by people who used to work for Privateer Press. Right. So they have minis backgrounds.
Right.
We know that their OP structure for Marvel Crisis Protocol is really good. They have a healthy amount of.
It's really good for what it is.
I was going to say, wait a second. It's good for what it is.
This is kind of where, it's not good for where I want to weigh in. It's good for Crisis Protocol.
Yeah.
If they just take the same format and smack it onto Legion, we're going to have a bit of a problem.
Yeah.
Because their format, for what it is very casual gamer focused. Show up at your store, play what you want.
How dare it be friendly.
And like most of what you're rewarded for, from my understanding of it, when I talk to the devs at Gen Con, is it's going to be all about, you know, participation prizes and just everybody who shows up gets stuff. And the longer you stay, the more games you play, the more stuff you get. And it's not necessarily tied to who wins.
So. I will say that I'm perfectly fine with that. I am fine with that to a point.
Like I like that.
Exactly.
But
we still need to have a prize. We still need to have a grand champion.
If that's what our quarter or not our quarterly, but our monthly kits, whenever COVID is over, turns into, I'm okay with that.
Right.
But if that's how Prime Championships and Gen Con and Worlds are going to turn out to be,
exactly.
I doubt it. I feel like that guy that you're speaking to is talking about that sort of reaching out to smaller communities kind of thing with that.
Yeah, and I agree, but it'll be interesting to see how it goes down. Now, I am actually really happy because this is where FFG really dropped the ball was in organized play, because they kept redoing their structure every couple years, sometimes even more frequent than that, to where Worlds dates are changing and when competitive seasons are changing. And then there were just huge stretches even before COVID where we didn't have anything. And I think getting all of their organized play under one roof so they only have to pay one team of people to do it could ultimately be a very, very good thing.
Yeah, I could absolutely see it work out well. I can. It's just a lot of unknown. That should be said too, I mean, even as soon as this was announced, the next day they put out it was pretty mild, but it was a Q&A. And again, it wasn't earth shattering Q&A, but at least it was them talking to the community, which is,
that is something we haven't seen from FFG in a very long time. So we are appreciative of that.
Yes. It's a good step. It's a good step.
I've been involved in a lot of the Crisis Protocol social media things, and they are all very, the company's very active with its fans, and they've they do a great job of making sure there's always something in the pipe, or at least something to be talked about. Like, here's the new release, here's the thing that's coming out soon. Like, they're very engaged with the community, and I know it's for that small game, but if they can keep that up, that'll be a good sign.
So I have seen some community people are worried about price, that, you know, Legion and what it does is the kind of not the cheap gaming version.
No,
but when
we're the budget game. Legion is definitely of all the big squad-based miniature games, but we're the budget game.
Well, because Warhammer can upcharge because that's their brand is upcharging.
Yeah, right. Their brand is upcharged. And we've started moving to the hard plastic, which does model better.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Like we've kind of had moved that process over, and prices have gone up a tiny bit.
Yeah, it's not
terrible.
But
not that much.
Yeah. But still better.
Protocol is a pricier game.
It is.
For the models that you get. But again, their models are fantastic.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I mean, the design setup and the way they mold them and all. I mean, all of it. Like, it is beautiful. And for the price, now, I can't imagine it going up that much. One, our models are smaller.
I wouldn't think so. I
mean, well, but our models are smaller, but we also get more of them. Like, when you buy a My Crisis Protocol box, you're getting one, two, or maybe three figures.
But you got to remember, this
those
is
cost
still
$30.
All like the branch company of Asmodee.
Yeah,
like, right. I don't think these things are going to be produced in a different factory in China.
No, I think
I doubt
take
it.
The same slow ass boat from China to, you know, San Diego.
Yeah, well, there's no storms.
Yeah. I'm a little trepidatious about price, but we'll, like I said, well, I don't want to judge them too harshly before we see anything.
I don't so even I am, know that's a thing that AMG will be controlling.
Yeah.
I don't. I think that'll be coming from Asmodee. So let's bring. I mean, this is probably a good thing for FFG because they were a board game company first.
Right.
And so, and I will say their board games have been a little lacking, I mean, in the last couple of years, like the new and innovative. I mean, they've done a lot with the existing IPs they have. But it's definitely one of those, like, I wouldn't mind seeing them get back into their board games.
Sure.
Right. Yeah, they make some solid games. Absolutely.
It'll be interesting to see where things go. I am cautiously optimistic. I do hate that we, at least right now, appear to have lost the dev team that we know. I don't have, you know, any concrete details, but we'll see what happens, and once convention season kicks back off and we start to actually get their first releases that are done under their house,
right?
Because I'm going to imagine that Lando and Callus, which have been unofficially announced, are still going to be FFG products, although.
Sure.
I don't know, looking at the boxes, if I saw the Fantasy Flight logo on them.
Yeah.
But I imagine those will be the last things we see from FFG.
From the FFG whole, but remember, it's all Asmodee.
They're just trading hands under the same company. Like, I get that.
Multinational conglomerates,
Raccoon
City.
Speaking of things FFG has given us, though, they did give us, after this shocking update, they did at least then
they
calm us down a little bit and give us
72 hours
early Christmas.
They'd be angry.
Yeah, 72 hours. And then everyone said, what? What's this?
So I have to ask, so did they hold this points update because they knew this was coming?
Yes, probably. I'm sure.
And like
did.
This is going to be like the thing that's going to smooth things over at least a little bit?
100%.
Probably, yeah.
Actually, I don't think so. But anyway, that's fine. I don't think that's the case. But
it must be the conspiracy.
No,
I'm all about Legion conspiracy.
But yeah,
so.
It's not a conspiracy. But no.
Looking at you, Chris Beezer. Looking at
you. Yeah, the RRG 2.0. Here we go. Let's talk about the faction that changed the least, the CIS.
Yes.
Because really, it didn't need a lot of changes. I mean,
really.
I would have always liked cheaper points. I mean, I always will like that.
Yeah.
But right. Will made a shocking, shocking piece.
It was a joke.
Yeah, it was a joke. Will was like, I don't know. You know, Droidicas are going to drop them to 80. And I was like, that's nonsense. You know, they got all this hull and health and shields, and that'll never happen.
They'll go down to 90, but not 80. And 80 was too far.
And then, sure enough, bam, there 80. It is. I'm like, wow.
I told you too.
I was an expert on droids.
I like it. It's delicious.
I don't know if this is
terrifying.
An attempt to get them to be playing a little bit more in the support category.
Yeah.
But at 80 points, I'm definitely going to have to consider that an I mean, because stabs aren't that much cheaper.
Yeah.
They really aren't.
I hate to say it. I think droidicas are going to be great at 80 points. I think they would have been good at 90 points.
Yeah. I think so.
Honestly.
But you're still not going to take them.
I mean, it definitely depends on the list you're trying to play.
Staps firepower is not honestly that far off of them. And they have the critical keyword. Mm-hmm. And they can daisy chain orders.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's those pieces.
So, like, they're more durable, and they can, you know, do this. They have this really cool ability that lets them stand still.
Right.
But with the speeder change, I don't know that droidica, like, I don't think it's a points cost on the droidica side of things. I think it's just the raw efficiency of the stab that if you're going to choose to take supports, you're going to choose the bike boy.
Well, ironically, it's almost a clone problem, right? Where it's like, the droidicas are not bad now. They're just not as good as this other thing.
I think it's less that and more that the stat plays a lot more into what your faction is wanting to get, where droidicas are good on their own.
Sure.
Stats are going to help everything and be pretty good.
Yeah.
That's fair. For future units, at least it leaves them in a design space where you can play with them if we get a lot less of the trying to, you know, give tokens to everybody.
Right.
It does.
Right.
Now, I will say Will predicted that aggressive tactics was too good on Grievous and should surely go up in points.
And it did.
And it did.
And 25% of the STABcast rejoiced.
Yay!
And the rest of us it was cried. So broken.
It was so broken on my faction.
I'm not really crying.
Those four tokens.
I hadn't used aggressive in a few months now because phase twos just make surges on their own.
What are you talking about? Like, and it's a drug. I've been clean from aggressive tactics for two months now. That's great.
Well, because it was stapled to every commander for about six months.
Surge token free. Surge token free.
But I will say, and so I stopped using it a couple months ago for the same reason, but actually it's the opposite reason.
The opposite reason.
I was only getting four of them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and it wasn't worth it. Like the point value, even at 10 points, to only get four surge tokens I couldn't share wasn't worth it for me.
Right. The real problem with aggressive tactics,
I couldn't.
The real problem with
all.
Aggressive tactics is that you can't put it on Iden, so therefore it's a worthless card.
No good.
Now that being said, in our play yesterday with the Imperials, I did have aggressive tactics on my commander, and I used it as much as I could, which is nice on those, you know, Imperial units that you need it for defense. Or the occasional offense. Like, it was kind of nice to have an option of at least a surge token.
Yeah.
Especially if you've got, like, something like scouts or guards. Yeah. Guards, I don't think surge hit, do they? So
No, they do not. They very painfully surge do not. None.
And you were running Dewbacks, who it's nice on them, because, once again, we were playing Saturday. We were playing weird stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All sorts of weird stuff was going on.
So it was nice in that kind of way.
Dewbacks, there was an E-Wave in a tank.
Now, Ryan predicted the Grievous would stay the same cost, but the gun would get cheaper. That did not happen. All of our lightsaber wielders lost like 5 points or more in general.
Some of us lost 10 points and it's still not enough, but that's fine.
Some of us didn't lose anything.
Nobody plays Commander Luke. It's fine.
All right. Well, that's... like,
we're in
I was
CIS
not
land.
In a million years
we're
expecting an Op Luke to get cheaper. Yeah, while we're talking about the light stick going down by 5 points, can someone explain to me why Commander Luke didn't? Because I am at a loss.
You're in the wrong section of this library, sir.
Yeah, I know, but we're just having a conversation about it. So
for 5 points for me, it makes up that aggressive tactics cost. I mean, that's the only point difference is the aggressive tactics.
Sir, this is
It's the same thing with Dooku. I mean, it's just 5 points down to pay for the aggressive tactics for me.
That's fair.
Now, I will say my B2s got a little bit cheaper.
Yeah,
they did. All the heavies for the sexy. B2s got cheaper. Oh, they really do. Yeah. And when I get that leader bot and those bell bottoms,
clanga, clanga.
You mean the leader bot that can just get choked out?
He can. He's a leader.
He can't choke a leader unless it's I don't even think he can.
Only model left. Yeah.
Okay. You say so.
Now, things that got cheaper I wasn't expecting at all was my B1 battle, like just a regular body.
Yeah, that's true.
And I know across the board, bodies went down.
Yes.
I was very surprised by that. My security bot went down. My bot went down. I was surprised to see those drops. None of my specialists went down.
Right, right.
Which is odd because poison's so bad. But
I think the leader, or not the leader, but the core unit specialist, but the personnel and heavy weapons mostly across the board getting reduced by about 3 points.
Yeah.
Is really interesting because they're trying when anytime you do a big points cut, I think 8 to 12 activations is where Legion really shines. If you bloat it and you get too high, games run too long. If you get it too low, then, you know, anyone who's played a late game of round six, and you've got 4 activations, there's just not enough flexibility.
Yeah.
And so with all these cuts coming down, they're really trying to incentivize us not to just add activations, but to pad the ones that we already have. And I really like that, to try to counterbalance so we just don't spam activations out. And now that it's actually cheaper to get a Rebel Trooper than it is, or four extra body rebel troopers than it is just to get a squad of rebel troopers with, a, right. with another order token.
No, I appreciate it. Like you said, I like the ability to flesh out my units, and it always feels bad, right? Like if you're looking at all your models set up somewhere, and you're like, here's the guys I actually use, and here's these guys that I never use because I can't afford to put them in the squad that they can.
Yeah, and it gives your squads a little more personality because each squad, and I know there's a lot of people out there, I don't understand you all, but it's why I play the faction I do, where they like all their squads to be very uniform. I like the fact that the game is pushing us into a place to where we're going to have the anti-vehicle squad, we're going to have the objective grabby squad, we're going to have our team that specializes in this, that, and the other thing. And that's gonna be really fun.
That is probably a good thing. I just don't like it, but I appreciate it tactically. Just aesthetically,
I also hate it.
Aesthetically, I hate it. That's the antithesis
they should
of what
Z6s,
I am.
Z6s. The end.
Yes,
it's an aesthetic problem. I'm with Tim. Yeah. It's also a self-loathing problem because invariably I put the squad that I need to do this particular tool set. The Phillips head screwdriver is on the wrong side.
You have the guy who's designed for job A in C's position, and vice versa.
Well, more like you deploy your rocket squad, and then they're like, "Oh, cool!" And their tank goes on the far opposite corner, and you're like, "Great,
exactly,
great, great."
Again, I think you're right, Ryan. I just aesthetically, I just don't like it. But I think it is, tactically speaking, I think it's the right way to go. This is,
yes.
This hurts.
Harkens Absolutely. Back to our last episode. Imperials could have been anything, and they chose to be boring. That's
tactically boring.
Now, the change I did not expect, and I really, and I'm not looking this gift towards the mouth, because I really love this change, is the speeder change.
Oh my gosh. I have many things to say.
I have so many things to say.
Oh, Tim sent us a hot take right after this thing, and I was like, oh, Tim, that hot take is so wrong. But let me just tell you what the move is first.
But it's fine.
Compulsory move can happen either at the beginning of your activation or at the end of your activation. And that opens up all the doors.
It does.
Yeah.
Like, that changes your entire gameplay with a speeder unit. Yes. And now that I have STABs, but I was a bike player back in the day.
Yeah.
I mean, I loved them to death. Ryan has played lots of the X-34, I guess, a year and a half ago.
Yep.
He had fun with them.
Oh, yeah.
And the T-47 has been trash bin for quite some time. I mean, they showed up at the last RPQs.
Yeah.
They did. They showed up, and people made valiant attempts with them. And they're fun to go, oh, look, there's a T-47. What the hell was that thing about? No, I mean, it's just one of those, it is a massive change.
Yeah.
And I do love it. I do like it.
So what was Tim's hot take for the listeners?
I would argue, and this is, I say this with every ounce of humility, and normally that I just shit talk myself and say how bad I am at this game. But I can be when I focus, and we all saw where I didn't focus, but when I focus, I can be damn good with bikes. I will say
sure.
that. But that last game, I failed against the bikes. Everyone's like, oh, bikes are competitive. Bull. Went 5-0 with bikes and a dewback. So don't tell me that the old ways are dead. But hold on.
Yeah.
Hold on.
Did that actually happen, or was that just a manic dream? I remember thinking about Tim's 5-0 run.
So it felt like it was 2.5 years ago. Only 6 months ago.
And if you want to say that's just TTS, like, no, I've done well with them in real life too. But anyway, again, just to say, I have a lot of practice with bikes. I hate this so much because it is absolutely the elitist snob in me that I think this just makes it too easy. I think this is spoon-feeding speeder, and I hate it. Bikes were a scalpel, and we just made the scalpel into a fucking chainsaw, and I don't like it.
Let me bring my counter perspective here, because I see where I truly do see where you're coming from. The problem on the other side of the table for me, though, is my bases are so big.
Yes.
It's really hard for me to line up shots two turns in a row. And now that I can, you know, move in, shoot a target, and move out, and I can keep beads on targets longer.
Right.
Turning the X-34 around, turning that land or the T-47 around with its huge base.
Right.
I mean, if you want to talk about getting good, like, the smaller the base, the easier it is to maneuver.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
Try moving an AT-ST base on a speed on that bike template.
Right. Now, I agree with you, and I will say too, the counterpoint to my own point, I do think it does open up actually more options to make them more unpredictable to play against, which I think is good as a bike player. That's good. I like that unpredictability. That's fun. I just don't like it still. I liked it the old way, but it's not like I'm going to stop playing.
I will say the very, very beginning T-47, if you didn't position that thing just right, not only did you not get shots, you died. Like, you killed yourself because you landed on a barricade. Right.
You landed on a barricade, and the only thing Empire really had to bring was literally HH-12s and DLTs, and so everything on the other side of the table
was
DLT. Had impact.
Oh, yeah.
We'll be bringing DLTs again, but that's fine.
Yeah, you definitely
And HH-12s?
No. HH-12s will not see the table.
Sad boy.
They will stay in the corner.
So, yeah, no, the speeder keyword, I think, for every faction is a great change to where, yes, I agree that it's got a lower skill floor than before, but I'd argue, Tim, that it doesn't have a lower skill ceiling.
I think that's fair.
I'm not going to say it's a particularly higher one either, but it does lower the floor. And all of us have now great speeder options. Yes. Like, speeder was just fell out of the meta because it was so easy to play around. You can just run out of your opponent's arc and know that they can't turn around to shoot you. And if they do turn around to shoot you, it's going to be an unmodified shot.
Right.
And with speeders typically having the not best attack pools.
Yeah.
Because even like the hugely expensive T-47 has six dice and they're decent dice, but it doesn't surge.
Right.
It felt real bad without a name token. Yeah, we'll get there. We'll get there.
Yeah, I know. I know. But no, I hear what you're saying. And again, I think in the long term, I think you're right. It's just when you practice really hard and get really decently good, I won't say really good, but decently good with something, and then just to see it get lowered, you're like, oh, okay. That hard work feels like kind of cheapened.
But the other thing is, I don't think your practice is invalidated by this. I don't think you have to retrain your brain. I think you're still going to have a leg up on people who, for the first time, are going to start to try to play Imperial bikes.
Yeah. I know.
Speaking of a faction that benefited from speeder keywords, let's go to the Republic.
Oh, yeah.
Pew, pew.
Oh, man. Your barks. That's what you want to focus on, huh? Your barks?
Yeah. Yes.
Well, last episode I spoke of the throne FFG constructed for me, and it is still intact. I'm pleased to report. It's still intact.
Yeah. They didn't get hit nearly as hard as they
took. They took one velvet cushion off of the throne.
That's right. Oh, man.
And actually, they kind of took the velvet cushion and then propped you up just a little bit with your foot pillow.
Yes.
They just moved the cushion. So let's talk about, before we get to Barks, let's talk about the big guy.
We don't even have to get to Barks, but yeah.
Barks are important now.
Barks are important now.
Hang on. I predicted the Barks were coming down in cost.
Yeah, I think that's the low-hanging fruit.
Exactly.
And then I predicted that R2-D2 was going to go up, but not likely to happen. It should go up. I wanted to go to 50 points. But I was like, FFG is not going to do it. I'd be shocked if they did.
Yeah.
We've gone up with R2-D2.
Yeah, 45.
Yep.
Is it 45? 45
is better.
It's better.
45 is better than 35.
It's better. Yeah. I mean, but it's not as good as 50.
Everything else coming down means his opportunity cost went up by quite a bit.
Sure.
So. Well, not that's everything.
Yeah. I mean, everything that was fine.
Right. But
Will, what about the arcs?
Well, let's talk about the clone trooper keyword that all of my men shall share.
That's right. That is an important thing.
This is the biggie.
Yeah.
For no longer shall the standby be shared between thine clone friends.
Unless you have Padme or Anakin.
Yeah, unless you have those two. But I just want to say that I was fully prepared for this since I never indulged in the standby side of things. I was a good boy.
Congratulations on your moral high ground.
Yeah. And the fact that I don't have to get used to not having it.
Yep.
Sure.
Let me read you what FFG said about the standby. When a mechanic is able to punish players severely for doing what they need to do to win the game, namely attack the enemy and advance toward objectives, it can feel like there's no right answer.
Yes.
There wasn't.
There wasn't.
It was Fort Clone, and if you spoke anything or moved nearby it, you would die.
That's right.
And so my problem is they should have waited this long for it. If they know this is a problem, because, I mean, this was a problem we had with X-Wing. Like, there's a space where they nearly killed their own game because they were unwilling to address the problem they had produced for almost a full year.
Killed it here.
That was the 2.0 change also killed it. But, I mean,
you're talking about Dengaroo?
Before that, the Dengaroo, yes. Yeah. That almost killed our game.
We definitely saw less people coming out because they knew that, a few certain people were unwilling to not play the oppressive thing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so that's why I kind of didn't use this, because I knew I could come on Wednesday night and set up Fort Clone and be like, har, 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 why'd you bother coming? And then they'd figure out, oh, I don't need to bother coming.
Right.
So, again, I quote the FFG, widespread standby token sharing is problematic for several reasons.
Right.
It is too powerful, too frustrating for the opponents of the Republic, and it leads to highly non-interactive game states.
That's all accurate. But we kind of knew that in July.
Yeah.
I was fine with it, honestly, until ARCs came out. Make it to where the person holding the standby has to be able to be the one to be in range. It has to trigger on them, but you can use any clone to share. But we don't got to worry about that at all.
Yeah, don't worry about that.
So back in January, I liked doing it with phase ones to try to catch people. Right, because it was still harder to do at the range two, and I didn't have as oppressive of things going on with free surges everywhere, just the aggressive tactics ones. But then the phase twos and the arcs coming out with trainings on them printed natively just made it like, oh, we can overwatch everything. And it just spiraled out of control there.
Yes. No, it's good. It needed to happen. I'm glad it happened. Hurry.
It did. It felt like bullying more than
clones. The clones are still the bullies. They're just like slightly better at hiding it now. That's all.
Yes, we are.
Yes.
Can you please read to me the last sentence of your boldface prediction from our last show?
Don't touch Obi-Wan, you sick bastards.
Yeah. How do you feel now that they did change Obi-Wan?
I feel like they touched him in the perfect kind of way.
This is fine. Yeah, this is fine.
It was his consenting zone.
Yeah,
Obi-Wan has gone down 5 points like most stick boys, as was discussed earlier.
Yep.
Boys or girls, sorry.
Yeah.
And it feels awesome. I've been running Obi-Wan for the past month or two exclusively just because I like him.
And like I said, I assume that's an aggressive tactics cost downplay.
Sometimes I run Obi-Wan without a command slot because I don't really need one.
Mm. Yep.
But I'm in favor. But it's great.
Yeah. I'm fine with it. Obi-Wan doesn't seem OP to me.
I'm not worried about that. I just thought it was funny that you told them not to mess with Obi-Wan and they touched him in a good way.
Yeah.
It's fine.
What do you know?
Yeah.
Arcs definitely went up.
Yeah,
Arcs went up 6 points for the big squad and the little squad.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Which is A-okay. So,
it's fine. They probably needed more than that.
They
got hit with a whiffle bat rather than a real one.
That's right. I think that the Arcs are okay, like that point cost. How did Fives and Echo not get messed with?
That's true.
I don't know.
Honestly, that's amazing to me because I don't understand that.
They need to at least swap the costs on them.
That's the big issue. Crazy to me.
Or lower the cost of Del Mico and like it doesn't. They're so much better than their Imperial counterparts.
You only get points adjustments on brand new out of the box units when you play my faction.
That's right. That's right.
Right.
Looking at you, Rebel Vets. Looking at you and your 36 point gun or whatever it's printed at.
I think it was just typed in wrong by someone. Someone was designing that card in the design group and was like, 36 is what it says here on that Excel sheet or Google Forms or whatever.
So what is amazing to me is that all of your phase one's heavies went down.
Yes.
So that's kind of in line with every other core unit getting discounted some parts of it.
They're trying to incentivize phase ones over phase twos as well. In addition to raising phase twos.
So a phase one with a Z6 and a phase two with a Z6. The phase two costs 14 points more now.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's still worth it.
And so while phase twos, the price of the squad went up, and I think the mortar came down.
The mortar came down 5 points because nobody plays it.
No one was playing with it. Yeah.
And they didn't touch any of the other phase twos, but since they cut the cost on everything else, that's almost like even the heavies went up because they didn't come down.
They cut the extra guy's cost like everyone else, but
they did? Okay.
He went down from 15 to 13.
Yeah.
So still not as much as other guys did.
You don't see a whole lot of people bringing the extra body on the phase twos anyway.
So. I did when I put fives in it because I was eight black dice, blah!
Yeah, it happens, but I'm not saying it happens a lot. Like, it's not...
Right.
Yeah.
But listen, we're burying the lead here. The AT-RT laser cannon down to 10 points.
Yes.
Neat.
Woo!
Hey, listen, in a soon-to-be tank-heavy meta, that's not a bad thing.
Exactly.
that's actually going to be kind of strong.
Problem is it only throws
one different die than what the actual base gun does, but it's the impact and range.
Yeah. I mean, it's red, black, black. That's better than black, white, white.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And it's at range four.
The tank meta. Yes. Why are we going to have a tank meta?
Well, you see, there's been an update to the field commander keyword because they're here to command from the field.
Oh.
rather than just sending out your push card that you have to use because Rex is dead, now you can make your field commander model your commander during list building.
Yeah.
And that's during list building. So it's not like I had to bring a commander and then drop them to something else.
Mm-hmm. Must be nice, guys. Must be nice to have
this,
that ability.
This, to me, I did not see coming at all.
I'm an Imperial player.
I didn't see this coming at all.
No, this is unexpected.
I think this may be an FFG ploy because people are like, I want to see an actual Ayla commander of my Jedi for... And there were a lot of that nonsense.
There's going to be that forever. They're going to be, why did you make Mace Windu and not Kit Fisto? You know, it's just going to happen.
Because one of them is in more than 40 seconds of the movie.
Oh. Yes. But at least this way, you'll be able to get that model from your third-party sources to put inside the top of your saber tanks. It'll be fine.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I think this is such a cool change. And I think it's... indirectly an answer to Ben's prayers.
Yes.
They don't have to take a 200-point Grievous. You can now take a 175-point tank.
That's right. Yes.
Which is pretty handy, honestly.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely.
And now you get, you know, because you get your base bravery of 2 and a bubble from that giant base.
Yeah.
Yep.
That bubble is huge.
That bubble is absolutely
huge. We were talking about how it helps out with operative play, for especially for Separatists, if you want to bring Cad Bane.
You can.
And you wanted a tank before that as well.
I think there'll be some Cad Bane tankless or even Maul tankless.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yeah, that guy.
I can guarantee you there's Maul tankless because I've seen them already. I've seen them out there in the meta worlds of trying to build things. People posting they're like drug-fueled dreams. They're like, what if I did this? What if I did this?
Now, I played
Tank and
Grievous just one time. And one of those, I did like it, because those two are absolute heavy hitters.
Yeah.
There just wasn't enough points for anything else.
Right.
It's scary.
Yeah. It is quite scary.
And but now I love the Republic tanks can be commanders with Ayla in them, so that's an Inspire 2 commander that I've always wanted.
God.
Exactly.
I needed a Leia.
To die.
With that Inspire 2, that's actually really Inspire at range 3. Or at range 2, because that base is so big.
That pie plate is so gigantic.
Oh, compared to a normal Legion Mini, it's like at least half of the range band out from it.
I mean, and honestly, I am kind of with Tim. They should have gone and retroactively added this to Weiss. Adding it to Wedge would be super scary, I think. Because it's a very, very cheap commander for a thing.
Yeah.
But these original trilogy players don't need parody on everything. We can have nice things, Ben.
It is cheap, but it's also more expensive than almost all of my, like, other than, like, Commander Luke.
Yeah.
It's the only...
That's true. It is the most expensive commander you own. So
well, because they all went down, because, you know.
Mine are still 175
and
200 points.
So
mine's still 90.
I get why they didn't give it to the prequel factions. I really do.
Well, Weiss is one of those, like, Wedge, all right, you can make a case he's not really, he's a fighter boy, got that. But Weiss is very much a leader on that field.
Well, and if
Wedge becomes a general, what are you talking about?
They all became a general. They all got generals.
That's because there were 7 of them.
It's this. It's that same Revolutionary War, I was rich enough to own land, and so I got a title.
Listen, I bought an army. Yeah.
If they're desperate enough to put Weiss down, I know we're jumping ahead a little bit, but it's fine. This is not a huge talking point. If they're desperate enough to put Weiss down to 1 point... then you tell me they couldn't just slap Field Commander on his card? Like, I'll write it on a Sharpie. Like, come on.
Right.
Because Weiss is only going to allow you to shoot more weapons, which you then spend more points to add.
Right.
Yeah.
Which then blank out because you don't have the search pile. So, yeah. Anyway.
I mean, all the things you say are mostly true.
They should have given Field Commander to Ryder Azadi.
God.
Yes. I'm in.
Now Ryan's back in.
So, yeah, I final thoughts on clones.
We're fine. The changes are good, maybe not enough, but probably fine.
Yeah, I would have liked to see them go a little further. But the clone meta is going to get shaken up because you get this huge standby change. Plus, Anakin came out the next day.
Yeah.
And I think Anakin will shake up the meta more than Maul will.
Anakin's so weird.
I think in the attempt to make phase ones more attractive, it may not be successful because phase twos are still so good.
Are still so good.
But it's definitely, it puts the question out there of, man, I could get, you know, 30 more points of upgrades if I just trim these down. And it's going to, It's going to put that question in my head instead of, no, so naturally phase twos, obviously.
Yeah.
Because list I was seeing posted was just like, and then you slap your four phase twos with Z6s in there and Overwatch on all of them. And I was like, oh, cool. Yeah. I don't want to do that.
Now that R2 is no longer 35 points, saving those points on phase ones doesn't mean you get an auto-include R2.
Right.
Exactly. That was a real problem. It was just throw them in the list and you win. So there you go.
Yeah. Sure. There was no debate on which one you chose. And now there's going to be based on if you want to try to save money or run the now much cheaper shotguns or Z6s or rockets even.
Yes.
Yeah. Or Barks. I mean, we kind of glossed over, but your Barks got cheaper and due to the same discussion about STABs.
Oh, Barks.
The speeder keyword got better.
Oh, my lord.
60 points.
Barks 60 points
even on your base weapon.
Yeah. Are you just so we don't spend too much time on it? Do Barks make it back in, or do they still get pushed out by infantry and ATRTs?
ATRTs.
I was seriously considering it though. They're 10 points less than an ATRT for 7 dice instead of 5. Like
armor's so handy.
The RT is very good, but now the Bark is an actual option.
It is absolutely an option. I agree with that. It's absolutely
which is where I want it to be a choice rather than. Naturally, I chose the ATRT.
It will never be a choice for me because I still have never built mine. So, therefore.
But I mean, a 60 point red, black, black, white with 5 health, surge to hit, red defense die, cover 1 speeder.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean,
and then you pay 15 for black, black, white, white.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Seems budget.
It's definitely solid. Seems budget. Yeah. I got no complaints against it.
That's a great cost point for that. And I get the armor, I do, but if you need something that's going to move fast and fly through there, that's what a Bark does. And now that you can control your speed, I mean...
So Keith messaged me and said, sorry for your loss about the changes, and I feel that I'm not in any way,
you're fine
doom and gloom about this.
Yeah. No. I think even most of the Republic players are pretty happy with what happened.
Yeah. The changes I wanted to see happened, and they didn't. They didn't bat it so hard that I have to really, we'll see.
Like they should have been like that scene in Office Space where they take the printer copier out back.
Right.
Should have been that.
I mean, I am for me for Repubs, and I guess this is the last thing I'll say on it is I am honestly super shocked that Rex or Padme did not go up.
Yeah,
that is
very shocked those two didn't go up.
It's
I
weird.
I really am.
I get
they
Padme,
definitely should have,
but Rex should have been messed with.
Padme should have gone up all to pieces.
Padme.
Yeah.
She is so utility. I mean,
she can be.
It's tokens. I don't like my command token. Here, you take my command token. Do you want to share my standby? I got quick think. I'm just going to hang out here and do some
stuff.
She
also dies.
And I shoot better dice.
Yeah, I mean, she does, but...
Yeah.
But I have a commander for the same cost that does literally all the same things, but worse for the same point cost.
This is what I'm saying.
Sorry, you're not exactly as cool as me.
But if only
Ascend's throne.
They should have just stayed with the Glorious Empire. That's all you needed. They could. No one had
are we
to
going
have
into Empire land.
We
speaking of giving
beautiful
cake,
it's wonderful land full of opportunity.
So amazingly, because Tim was not on last week's episode, all our predictions about the Empire were mostly wrong.
Because Tim brings accuracy to our predictions.
We did say Boba Fett needed some help.
Yes,
point wise, duh. We did say the Imperial Royal Guards needed help. Which they didn't get.
They didn't get.
Right.
And that range 1-2 Imperial really needed some point reductions.
Yes.
Or a different player base.
Or
a different player base.
Yeah.
And yeah, they got that.
The different player base or no?
Both. I think both.
All the clone players are coming back. It's a new player base.
Yeah. That's exactly it. Now, I will say the point cost going down on them, and we've all agreed the Dubaks have got to go down.
Yeah.
We did.
Oh,
but Tim lead us
more,
through,
more so than
most
all,
of this conversation is really about
you. It's so good. It's so good. So I was in the camp of hoping for either Dubaks at 75 or the point of the gun dropping down to free or cheap or like a little bit of both. I didn't expect to get dues at 75 and the gun dropping 5 points each per gun.
Yeah.
Not that I'll ever bring the other guns, but still. At least it makes it a little bit more of an option. So the fact that dues are 75 now, oh my gosh, it has been such a swing.
It makes a huge difference.
It's such
a
swing.
It makes
a
huge difference.
Oh man. Armor 1, like all the, I can't get over all these lists I'm making, basically. My question is now, I used to ask this question as a joke almost, of like, I'd like to fit a Dubak in here just to see if I could. Now it's put the Dubaks in a list and then build around the Dubak.
So...
So does this invalidate everything you said up above talking about bikes just because they take the same slot as Dubax for this relatively the same cost?
It doesn't invalidate it, but it just makes it like I really probably will now take Dubax instead of bikes, which
that's what I'm saying. Yeah, like I have all this practice with bikes, but screw that. I'm playing giant lizard people.
Right. It breaks my heart a little bit because I love bikes. Here's my other problem, and I won't go off on this huge tangent here, but and I've talked about this before. There's something to be said about Dubac double bike. I can't say the same about double Dubac single bike because the single bike unit just gets punked so easily.
Yeah.
And you just die. Yeah. So I can't switch around, and I wish I could. I wish I could because I would love to still bring a unit of bikes, but they're just going to die. So,
well, I think bikes and staps to a degree as well. When you the more the merrier because they are built to hammer a single target every round where they just kind of follow each other around.
Yeah. But no, I'm in love. It makes me so happy. I don't think they're broken. I think it's just going to make them really competitive. I think they're still easy to kill if they get focused down. Because Armor 1 can backfire on you with the right guns.
Sure.
And then also, they don't surge on defense. So, like, there's red dice, but it's still, there's a chance. So, unless you get kind of lucky, they can still die. So, Ryan
predicted the tyranny of the 3 Dubac list.
I think it's going to happen. I think way more common is going to be double Dubac. But also, I was actually thinking about this before we started recording. I used to not like taking just one Dubac because you're paying all these points, kind of like the single bike problem, paying all these points to die. Whereas now, even if I bring one Dubac and then you focus fire on it, I've only paid 75 for it.
It's soaked up the points.
Right, it's soaked up the points. Yeah, it's soaked up the actions. It's made its money back way better. And it's your ROI on the Dubex. If we're going to start talking marketing on it, like your ROI, invest in Dubex. Dubex stocks are shooting up. It's great. Invest.
Well, there's one thing that's going to bring that stock down, but we'll talk about that in a minute.
Yeah, you're not wrong. Yeah.
The thing with my hesitation with like the triple Dubex list is it's, and there's a lot of versions of this in Legion, but you have an answer or you don't.
Right.
Either the triple Dubacs are going to maul you because you don't have a way to deal with them, or you're going to deal with them and it's going to be such a poor investment for the Imperial player, or the Dubac player, I should say, that they just weren't worth it at all and the game is just kind of over turn two whenever the Dubacs melt.
Again, I don't see triple Dubacs being a thing. I think it is a thing. I know for a fact that there are I know there's Vader triple Dubac lists out there right now, but I don't think super common.
Sure.
Double Dubac's way 80 more.
80 points to get the ranged weapon for your Relentless.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's worth
exactly.
It. Even if it's 4 white dice, honestly, 80 points.
4 white dice crit too. Like,
pretty that's good. Yeah,
even if you don't take the tactic of charging your Dubacs in, hoping that the armor and red save will get you there, I could see you trying to like double envelop with these guys on the flank and just kind of running around darting between terrain pieces.
The great thing for Endurance Dubacs is they can hold a flank. They tend to hold a flank. Even if they die, they tend to soak up the hits long enough to hold the flank, long enough that it matters.
And they give cover to units behind them.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because like Tawns, you have to kind of play as shot cavalry.
Yeah.
You can play a Dubac, I think, as a missile cavalry unit who just kind of hangs out, doesn't die.
Yeah.
Doesn't do the most damage, but is a worthy distraction.
Yeah.
While if Tawns aren't getting engulfed in melee, they're just kind of garbage.
The other thing I'll say about it, and then we can move on, is I do think with the point drop on the Dubac and the gun, this makes an interesting option of playing it kind of like you were saying, right? Of like almost kind of what's the term in gaming? Kiting, like just kind of kiting around on the edge of just running around, and then you know maybe mid game if they're still around, being able to charge in and do your thing. But you can just take the slow approach with that range 4 gun. So it's definitely
again, because the melee threats get very big once the periphery starts to dissipate and you're down to 6 activations,
which could be the new way to play dudes. I don't know. This is uncharted territory now. So
it's going to be fun to watch you people try to figure it out.
Yeah, it'll be good. It'll be fun. ATST went down 10 points. Neat. Hooray.
Neat. Needed to happen. Neat.
It's fine. I was playing him before. It's nice. It's a nice little pat on the back, but, the other thing that is armor went down as well. I think it's like a tank or something like that. I don't know. It went down 10 points. The big thing for armor, for our tank as well, I should say, is that open transport rule.
Yep.
The point change is great. 10 points down, it makes it more playable. But
it's nice.
Yeah.
It's nice. But that open transport rule, you drop an E-Web in the back, which I've done before.
Yeah.
But you normally have to get the E-Web in the field so you could deploy it and then shoot the thing. And
you're like,
it just took too many activations to do.
Yeah, and you're just trying to slingshot your E-Web or something like that. And
yeah, that's exactly.
Oh, but this is, it is my E-Web because you lose fixed front when you're in the back of the transport. Yes.
Yeah.
So it was just puddling around. The tank would move. They'd try to shoot and blow some things up. And the E-Web was like, whoa, what's over there? Rotate. I mean, it was fantastic for the
point. Which also, on a side note, since we're talking about that, E-Webs didn't get touched, but generators went down to 3 points, which is...
Please use generators.
Such a drop. But barrage generators on E-Webs are so freaking good. Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
You surge crit. That's more options for a crit plus the suppressive. Like, they're so good for 3 points. Mm-hmm. I don't think if you can ever justify not bringing it, unless you're going to say that the E-Web will never leave the tank, which is an option, I guess.
It is an option.
Which, again, right now, we don't have to go off on this tangent, but right now, without clarification, it looks like generator doesn't maybe work in the tank. I'd be fine ruling and saying it does, but
is it doesn't. My reading says that it does not.
Yeah,
you lose that keyword on there.
I think raw it doesn't. I think I don't know what the intention was. So hopefully we
can clarify. And honestly, that kind of makes, like, if we want to go lore wise, that kind of makes sense that one guy's in the back of the pickup truck holding the generator, waiting to plug it in once they get out.
Yeah.
And again, for 3 points, that's fine. Like, that's
Who cares?
That's
okay. Exactly.
But yeah.
Honestly, 200 points for the Gav and the E-Web, I don't mind making that a paired unit. That's
absolutely
a great use of 200 points.
Yeah.
And when your Gav tank rolls the right red dice, which mine didn't yesterday.
Yeah.
All those surging red defense
dice. I've been there.
Never seen so many surging red defense dice in my life.
Well, so hold on. We should clarify what the actual open transport rule is, because we're not actually
saying. Yeah, that's what I was about to do. Yep.
We probably should.
Yeah, we should clarify. So the new rules for open transport, which is for the tank and also for Ryan's other faction that no one cares about, but is that when shot at, you can actually shoot at the unit in the back of the tank, or in the transport, I should say, in the transport that's open, but they get automatic heavy cover.
Yep.
And they can now likewise shoot out of the vehicle and use actions and things like that. Basically, they are performing everything normally from the tank and using the tank's base for these things as well.
As long as the vehicle hasn't already moved twice this activation.
Yes,
if it has moved twice, you get a single action and no free action.
But with that oblong base on the tank, like, you can move once and you're fine.
You just
exactly. Yeah, like,
hello.
It's a little trickier for the X-34 since it's a speeder.
So I actually did this to Brett. But... his little Force Adept character, was it range 3 from the side of my tank?
Yeah.
And so I just rotated to the right and didn't move. I just pivoted. And now I was at range 2. Because that oblong base, that oval base is so big. I mean,
yeah.
It's so good. So good.
The other big change, and I'm sure there are other changes like this in the rules reference guide, but this is the one that I picked up on, is they highlight in nice blue text the things they add, but they never indicate the things that they took away. And so previously, whenever you would shoot a vehicle transporting someone, the transportee would also take damage. But now that you're allowed to target the units inside, you don't take damage when the vehicle takes damage anymore, which is great. Unless the transporter is destroyed.
Right.
So it is something to keep in mind that if you've been playing open transport units for a while and you've got it in your head that if Leia's in the speeder and the speeder takes damage, she takes damage.
Sure.
That's no longer the case.
And
I'll be honest, the Gav tank has always been a good weapon. It's low to the ground, so terrain sometimes means you can't shoot high. But it's always been a good tank. I mean, that red defense die does wonders with armor.
I still think
when
so,
the red defense die rolled.
No, that's very valid. And I think the conversation now just becomes... The Gav I will bring if I'm going to bring something to put inside of it. Otherwise, I just bring the AT-ST. Because that height on the AT-ST is just unmatched.
It makes all the difference.
But again, if you're going to use it as a super armored technical, absolutely. Easy.
Well, and now that Palp can pull the strings from within it and it gets the reach of that huge base.
Pull the strings and barrier from it, no less, kids. So barrier all around everybody. Yeah, that's I'm A-okay with that. And again, heavy cover. Put Vader in it and take some swipes. That's fine. Vader's
saber throw.
Sometimes Vader gets caught in the open. If he's in a tank, he's always going to be at least in heavy cover.
Exactly.
That's helpful.
There's that.
You know.
All right.
Really is that.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the most trepidatious change for Tim here.
So, listeners, I love Vader. I think he's one of my favorite models in the game. He's not my favorite, but he's in my top three, probably. He went down to 175, which is great. And I'm talking Commander Vader because I'm not going to waste my breath talking about Operative Vader. So talking about Commander Vader, went down to 175, which is great. Very helpful. Great for list building. Huzzah. The problem is not his points. The problem is Vader himself. He just doesn't have enough things that he can do with his list. Now, barrier helps. Barrier helps. But now you have to think of, what do I drop on him? Do I drop choke? Which is probably going to be the case. I'd probably drop choke to put barrier on there, which hurts because choke is so good. He just doesn't feel scary enough. And I don't say that he's useless by any means, but it's just hard. It's hard to justify it.
And this, I think, goes back to what Will and I were talking about. I think it requires a fundamental shift in Imperial vision to play it.
Well, and that's
because you have ISFs who can infiltrate next to him if you want to. You've got all, I mean, you've bring Iden next to him if you want to. Well, you have units that can play the 1-2 game range now.
I don't know
that the Imperials are ready for it.
And that's kind of the problem, too, is that, like, Vader, you really just have to be super conscious about what you build around him. Like, there's certain other Force users that you can kind of build your list and throw your Force user and be like, haha, cool, neat. Like, you really have to make your list Vader-centric, which I don't think is bad. It's just hard to do. And the other problem, too, is that, like, if he goes toe-to-toe with pretty much any other Force user in the game, like, he normally comes out losing that battle, traditionally. Maybe not every time, but traditionally.
I think dues coming down.
Yes.
And some of your other long-range options getting less strong are going to help that.
Yes. And Vader dues. That's why Vader dues are a thing all of a sudden.
Yeah.
Because everyone wants to do that. They do have good cohesion.
Yeah. And new ways to motivate them on a dueback is insane.
Absolutely. I think that's going to be a very powerful list.
Yeah. It's once again one of those things you're going to have an answer for.
Yeah.
Or you're just not.
yeah.
And I don't know. I'm maybe this is the reason we didn't see any update with the IRGs.
Yeah.
Is because if you bring IRGs, Vader and Dubacks down, and we'll get to it, Shore Troopers up.
Yeah.
Maybe that just shifts Imperials all the way from range 4 to melee range 2.
I don't think that's the
only thing we see. I don't know. Because if you make your whole list indestructible.
So IRGs they're very are destructible. Fine. You have a surge hit problem,
right?
Because you throw black dice. I mean, it's an issue. It is, but it's. Yeah. I still think IRGs could have come down because I don't think they're seeing play.
Yeah, and again, and
even their Guardian 2 is cool, but I often lose them. They often die.
Well, and again, barrier's going to be interesting on Vader, and I do want to just further reiterate: I don't think Vader is awful.
No,
he just doesn't feel good enough. He is so
close. And I'll also say this, so Tim. Close. I don't think Vader is your playstyle.
No, I agree with that. I agree with that.
Yeah.
I think it's really I really enjoy when I pull him off, but I don't think I'm good at playing Vader normally.
There's a joke there that I'm not going to.
I know. I'm aware.
So Vader goes down. Vader goes down. You don't like him.
Vader goes down to 155. But yes, shores go up. Mortars go up, and that's fine.
We're all shocked.
Yeah, I guess we should clarify exactly what they went up for people who are blind.
Mortar went up 2 points.
Yes, and the Shore Trooper itself did not go up. In fact, the
T-21,
the spare body on the Shore Trooper went down to 10 points, which I think is a nice touch.
Everyone else's did.
But the T-21 gun, while all the other heavies went down, that one went up.
it deserves it.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's fair. I've had some pushback from some other friends that have said, like, I don't think it was much of an issue. They're wrong, Josh.
It was.
It's fine. I will call you up by name. I think we kind of got blinded by the looming threat of Gar and how scary they became. Because before that was an issue, the talk of the town was Tauntaun's overpowered and Shores overpowered, undercosted. So I think if we fix some things about Gar and don't touch either of those units, I think
we just go back to that same.
Yeah, we're just rewinding to where we were last year. It makes perfect sense. I really like. I've never been a huge Shore Mortar fan. I hate the 333 list.
I mean,
so
you say that, But in almost all the lists I've seen you play in the past 6 months, yes, have had shores and mortars to some degree or another.
Oh, absolutely. Them. They're always in there. But I'm saying a lot of people will just run like either triple shore, triple mortar. My previous thought was that the sweet spot was 2 and 2. I think with this change, I'm totally fine going 1 shore, 1 mortar. Or my personal favorite, which I've been toying around with a lot more, double shore, no mortars, put E-Webs in there, and let the E-Webs get the free orders.
I'm a fan of this plan.
Yep.
I like this, but I also like E-Webs. I've always been
Same here.
I mean,
yeah.
The more expensive they are, but I mean, to be able to sit and standby, all those dice surge crit.
It had to happen. It should be noted, I've been playing with Palp a lot. Palp went down 10 points. Hooray. I think he probably should have gone down 15 points only because with Barrier coming out, like, you've taken 10 points away and there it is again with Barrier.
Yeah, but right back. But Palp, you make him too cheap. He's so strong because absolutely. He pairs well with whatever heavy hitter you've got. And even like Snows came down.
Yeah.
And I know we'll get there. But Palp and Snows are so good together, even if you don't have a Bossk or somebody else to order, because they get that extra move and that attack. Yes. So they're marching towards objectives and getting to shoot multiple times a turn.
Yeah. No. I think Palp, I would have loved her to go down 5 more points, but I think 200 is fine as well.
If Palpatine was 195 and Dooku was 200, I'd throw a hissy fit.
That's fair. That's fair.
So this is a thing. Tim and I have battled over this. I really love the change to DTF.
Yeah.
I love it.
I love this
change. I just don't love it enough. it's the problem of that's really good. That's rakes are really good. If I run a Death Trooper, I'm probably just going to bring DTF and never touch that DLT again. But I'm just going to bring ISF instead. I'm just most likely,
I get that.
Unless we're running Krennic, you know.
There's something to be said. Looking at you, Michael Henry, about that surging red save on the DT.
Sure.
Yeah, I mean, and if you go Iden and drop her down to your operative, then you make this guy your leader. Yeah. He has Compel built into him.
Yeah, I think it's a she, isn't it?
Which I don't think enough players are using when they do pull Krennic, because he's so far in the back line with his damn binoculars.
And Imperials are allergic to movement templates.
So now people are just going to put binoculars on DTs.
That's right. I mean, you're not wrong. That's a thing we could do. It's not going to happen, but it's a thing we can do. It's the power we have.
How do you feel about binos on Iden, Tim? We need to know.
No, absolutely. Absolutely not. Get the hell out of here. Don't ever talk to me or my child again.
We were afraid.
That's our litmus test.
You're afraid you'd be one of those people.
No. Okay. Absolutely not.
Yeah, no, I think DTF is going to be awesome. Like, the fact that the point cost didn't get touched and we're just like, here, have an extra hit point.
Yeah. Oh, well, extra so hit good. Point. And then also, I mean, it is also, it's skinny Krennic, you know, like you get compelled.
Yeah.
Like,
yes, it's skinny Krennic.
There's a list saved in my profile right now that I've been messing with. That has at least one DTF trooper, if not two squads of them, with double Dewback, because then the Dewback gets Compel. Like, hey, that's pretty sweet. Mm-hmm. It's pretty nice.
That's what I'm saying.
So it opens up a lot of solid options. Change. Yeah. I could see a lot of where DT, like, now you're going to get the one squad of DTs thrown in there, which is fine.
And I know people complained about DTs, not in the reason they kind of faded from the meta. I don't think it's ever because they got bad.
No.
It's because clones became so good and shores became so good.
Yes.
And shores were a cheaper option to do.
Shores were way cheaper. Yeah. Now your prices are a little bit
more. And they did pretty much
even.
The same thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's fair. But no, I think you'll see a lot more DTs, but I think it's a very good fix. Let me say that. I think it's very solid. Also of note, just to move it along, Snows went down to 44, which is the same as a naked storm. So I'll probably just always bring naked snows instead of naked storms now.
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, I snows lose precise, boohoo, but you know, whatever.
You lose precise and you lose more viable heavy weapons. But if you're not, if we're talking just naked troopers, absolutely.
I just mean naked troopers. Yeah, yeah.
Because you just get to move twice and shoot. I mean, it's so good.
Exactly, yeah.
I will say, I did predict that the full scouts and commandos needed to drop to 50.
Oh, man, 48.
And then Imperial scouts dropped to 48.
Yeah.
I was like, wow. Yep.
That's crazy to me.
That's crazy.
I mean, good for them. I hope we see them.
Yeah.
Low profile, sharpshooter, and you've got scout. You throw two white dice a piece, so at least you're throwing eight white dice.
Unfortunately,
another range one to two.
Unfortunately, it means that now I have to build my scout troopers. I don't actually have them built. I only have the. Yeah, I only have the.
We found that out Saturday.
Sniper units.
So now I don't know what I'm going to do. I just have to run like four snipers and say like, no, there's actually no snipers in here. They're just all scouts.
Oh, I mean, it's so good.
All right. The biggest change, though, the one none of us saw coming. Covert operations. We're not going to try to save this garbage card. We're just going to scribble it out and do it again.
I love it. I mean,
I do too. It probably won't see much play, but I love it.
Yeah. So the command card now says, this is for covert observation, the one pip generic. When an opponent's issuing orders using a command card, each unit that is issued an order with that card gains one suppression token.
Yeah.
I mean, I love this as an anti-clone card.
Yep.
I do.
Yep.
No one's playing an entire Legion, although I still love that card.
Yeah. Yeah, an entire Legion against this, yeah.
I play that card all the time if I'm playing Pal.
I mean, I can see this is a great card to pair up with Annihilation Looms.
Yes.
Played in the right spot.
Either back-to-back or as the most experienced team tournament TO.
Gross.
you play those on the same turn with your teammate. It's going to be real lousy.
Gross.
No, I think it's a great fix. I don't know that it takes the spot of Ambush. Maybe it does if you're running, you know, single commander or generic with an operative.
I think it just depends on your list. I think if you're going to go for a suppression heavy list, like I could see this. How about this? If we're just going to, I don't have this mathed out or built anywhere, so I'm just speaking off the top of my head and thinking of what points I can remember. Like if you just have a bunch of, after I just said I'm not a huge mortar fan, but if you're talking about suppressive, right? If you're talking like yes. Bosks and some mortars with some E-webs with barrage generators that are now 3 points, yeah, I could see that because you're just going to load up on suppression. Sure. Mm-hmm. I think if you're trying to go for that suppression game, which of course is something Imperials do, I think it absolutely makes sense. So it's good that it's an Imperial card. Like it'd be weird for any other faction.
Yeah, and I could actually, I hadn't really thought about that, but since you say this, I could see you replacing Bosk's one pip with this.
What's his one pip off top of my? His grenade. I can see it
because so far off. If you want to play Bosk back, this helps keep people back and slows them down. How often is your Bosk actually in grenade range before he's dead?
Ooh.
Like if they get that close, he's probably close to death.
Ooh.
Yeah, and it's normally you're close to death around before you're like, well, might as well do some explosions before I die. Pop, pop.
Yeah,
oh, I see this. This card would be really good with a Pelt Bosk list. Actually,
sure.
Yeah, it would be. Yeah.
Not to show my hand, but
it's good. This is a podcast, and not a YouTube show. So you can't see your hands.
No, yeah. I really do love this thing, and I'm very glad Minesweeper Dio is also out.
Oh so, man, you know, no, that was that that breaks my heart. That was so fun.
No,
one time I set off 3 Cad Bane tokens with 1 Dio. It was great. It's so good, and he's like, "What do you mean?
This
I can't
is why
shoot?
Your faction is not respected. Not respected.
Oh, I miss it.
Yeah,
but
everything feels kind of right for the Empire. I was surprised how cheap all of their core upgrades and stuff got. Yeah. Like, I think they are gonna swing back to an infantry heavy faction where you'll pick one other slot,
right?
And it'll either be a tank or 3 supports or, you know, 3 special forces. Yep.
Which makes sense.
But I think they're going back to their roots of more versatile gun line than just range 4 mortars that sit back on their haunches.
Right.
So it'll be cool.
Yeah, I'm all for it. I think it was a really, obviously I'm the Imperial player, but I say this as balanced as I can. I think it was a really solid fix. I don't think anything was too overtuned. Maybe you could argue the Dubacks went a little bit too low, but I think it'll be fine.
Yeah, time will tell with that.
But I'm not complaining about that.
So let me tell you about my predictions for the Rebels, because I was mostly right on this. I'm taking a lot of victory here. Wookiee Warriors came down to an even 100 points.
Yep.
Well, with the Bowman, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. With the Bowman. Yeah. So, I mean, he's 69 points for the 3-man squad.
Right.
Nice. But not only that, it got all the keyword changes it should have had. Like,
yeah.
I mean, Will joked about this. Oh, look, we found a better keyword after we made these models.
Yeah.
Yeah. But they also get Duelist, which is really good.
That surprised me. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, Duelist. Spend this dodge token to not worry about running up into melee with a lightsaber wielder.
Yeah, because they're the Wiki's biggest problem is most of the targets that you want to melee and use that big health pool to make them chew through.
Right.
Yes.
Is against lightsaber people because like Wookiee's damage, if you just compare them to their counterpart on the IRG, their damage in every way, shape, and form is lower. But it's just the sheer amount of health that you get. Mm-hmm. But now that they can spend a dodge token for an attack and not only negate a result but also become pierce immune, is crazy good. Getting them a dodge token is going to be a little trickier, but.
I mean, we saw R2-D2 go up on that side as well,
so that's always
nice.
Yeah, yeah. I actually think it affects Gar players since their activations and their upgrades are more expensive than it does us.
Yeah.
I was never a huge R2-D2 player personally, but it will affect us. I think it just affects us.
Yeah, less. I think that's totally fair.
I predicted Pathfinder should go down. They didn't go down anywhere near far enough.
They did not go down anywhere near enough.
But nope. They at least dropped 10 points, so that's a good thing.
Yeah.
It's a thing that
Commandos got cheaper.
That no one will care about.
Yeah. I mean, Pow and Biston got some extra health. Biston came down in cost. They're fine. I still don't think, especially with Commandos coming down, the full team. I think the Rebel Commando with a sniper, the full squad, isn't bad. Like, sharpshooter on a reasonably sized dice pool isn't terrible with Pierce.
With a surge to hit? No, I like it.
Yeah,
I'm I like the that. And I've always liked the full squad sniper on the Rebel side. I really have.
So we'll see what happens with all that. But we all need to hail our new overlord.
No.
The T-47 Snowspeeder.
Oh, God. It's terrifying. It's so terrifying. It is
most amount of changes that I would have ever expected, and a point cost reduction at the same time.
Oh my God.
Yeah, so this is its second point cost reduction because in the first update it got cheaper.
Hey, join Vayner and in that club. And ATSD.
And it added some keywords to make it not just blow up to grenades and saber throws.
Right.
They did. Still kind of saber throws, but holy cow, surge crit.
It is absolutely the thing that vessel needed.
Surge crit, new speeder rules.
I thought it needed surge hit
points.
Yeah.
Oh, this thing is bonkers.
Yeah.
You know, so when I was afraid of the dewback, you know, if they make them too cheap and you get all these hit points of red saves with armor.
Armor one. We only get armor one. Wait a minute here, Bucky.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah,
but now, because Impact doesn't care what number comes after the armor keyword.
Yeah.
So now that the T-47 gets to roll six dice, granted they are very good dice, at a dewback, like this thing is just going to slay dewbacks left, right, and center.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. I'm very aware of the danger.
And it's going to be absolutely hilarious.
But we're going to end up seeing a return of DLTs, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do too.
That's why
I can see
that's why all my lists that have RTCs, I still love the RTC. But for a cheaper DLT, which I guess we kind of mentioned it offhand, DLT went down to 22 points.
Yeah.
I'm just going to be subbing out all my RTCs for DLTs again. We're coming back, baby.
But man, if this is a big if, but with the field commander changes, the open transport changes, the airspeeder changes, I think every piece of armor got significantly buffed, with the exception of maybe the Republic RT, but it indirectly is going to get help because everything else that it was competing for points for went up.
Right.
If we do hit an armor meta,
it's happening.
I don't think I go to a 4-round event and not bring a T-47 because it's fine if there is no armor across the table.
There's going to be.
But it is going to Shrek anything that does for half the cost.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sure is.
Yep. Absolutely. From a CIS standpoint, I don't have a lot of impact. And so I'm going to have to bring Rocket Boys.
Well, and this is what's funny. You're talking about it murdering dewbacks, which I think is fair. But this is also why I'm bringing those crit guns, because crit 2 on there is going to be my only hope of dear God, please, please.
You pray for a surge.
I'm going to aim,
and at the end of the day, you know, it's just got cover 1 and it does have the ATSD surging white save.
And armor.
And it doesn't have a ton of hit points, but it's got its armor. Yeah. With your critical armor and your impact, those hits are more than likely going to go through. Yeah. But yeah, no, T-47 is, I mean, whew, is it juicy?
It's, they should have just labeled the whole RRG fix like, this one's for deck. And like, just put it in.
Wedge in it is going to be like this to me, oh the speeder God. Change.
Yeah.
Now that, because the problem with Wedge is you had to do your compulsory move before you could reposition with Wedge with the new, mm-hmm. the second edition Wedge fix where he gets to let you pivot for free instead of a 180 pivot for an action.
Yeah.
He's now likewise only a point, but Ooh. Now that I can pivot before my compulsory move means you are never going to know where Wedge is going to go.
I was gonna Which say, is what I think they were that, trying for.
Unlike yeah. Weiss, he's actually useful. So.
Now, but like Weiss, is he worth the opportunity cost of the outer rim speeder jockey?
What speeder jockey do? I forget.
Makes it gives cover two. You cover one, so it makes it cover yeah, two.
Absolutely. Your armor. You're fine. Oh, my God. Yeah.
So hang on. That cover one got me a lot yesterday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because cover happens before you convert.
Right.
For impact.
Impact.
Yes.
And so that two red die DLT that you split fire onto the snow speeder, getting one through because cover will take one, but then the other will convert, it shuts the DLT down to where you have to focus more on
yeah.
more dice onto the snow speeder.
Right. I understand.
So I don't know. It's tough, but yeah, Wedge is gonna be a ton of fun to fly and just keep your opponent guessing.
I mean, I hated playing against speeder jockey on the land speeder, so air speeder is going to feel even worse, I feel like, since you can't
yeah.
you can't just go hit it with a stick.
Or throw a grenade at it.
Or yeah. use blast.
Or use blast. Yeah, I mean, I'm looking at my tank for the CIS, and I really do only have one set of shells, because mm-hmm. my tank has crit 2, not impact, built in. I actually it has one impact, sorry. Has one.
Well,
impact.
Crit will trigger before the cover, so yeah, it will. But at that point you're just looking for surges. Yeah. So
but they're red dice.
Yeah. But they're red dice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, I'm gonna see lots of hits.
Yep.
Yeah.
So it's gonna be cool. I'm super, super excited. I thought the T-47 would just come down in cost. This surge to crit, I mean honestly, surge to hit is what it needed.
Yeah.
Surge to crit's just surge to even crits. Better.
It is bananas. Ooh, my two man. Air speeders are in the mail.
Yeah, it is a
okay.
Rebel infantry getting cheaper across the board.
Yep.
My shotgun Authorian and my rebel trooper squad, 17 points.
Yep.
Be still my beating heart. Fleets are now got the snow trooper treatment where they're the same cost as their counterparts. Although the scattergun did not go down in price, which is probably fine.
I would say Rebels have had the most point changes.
Yep, hashtag overtuned. That's it, there it is.
Yeah. they have had
We also needed them.
I mean, they were in the dumpster, and now they're just the dumpster lid. Yeah.
Right.
Sabine getting buffed, the thing that no one asked for, but we're just happy to have with a much cheaper Darksaber and a cheaper shield.
Yeah. I saw.
I was kind of surprised by
that. No, I saw people talking about the shield is good, it's just too expensive, so I can understand that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did her little whipcord thing get decreased?
Nope. That needs to be free, and I still don't know that I take it.
Yeah, I've never seen that in play, I think. Maybe like once or twice when it first came out. Yeah,
because it's an action. You make it a free action, and I'll take it. Yeah. But like other than that, her shield and recon intel is going in that slot.
Yep.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah, lots of good changes. Like most of them revolving around their speeders. The X-34 got cheaper,
yep.
and all of its weapons except for the rifle, the two white dice rifle.
Yeah.
Got some help.
The free harpoon off the back, guys.
Yes,
that's fine. Yeah, that's great. It's fine.
It's rear arc only, so you can't like add it to your six die attack.
Yeah. It's one of those nice things. Like, there's going to be more armor.
There's going to be more armor. There's going to be more things to spin around.
Mm-hmm.
So that may end up being more impactful.
Uh-huh. Spin to win, kids.
Speaking of impactful things, what if your communications got sabotaged, Ryan? What if they got sabotaged in a different way?
Yeah. So while the Imperial one pip got completely reworked to where it doesn't do the same thing it did, this this card does the same thing. It just does it in a more better, meaningful way.
Now, what did the old one do? Just to remind.
The old one reduced the number of orders that your opponent gets to issue from their command card by one to a minimum of one.
So an entire legion, you just forgot to send a memo to that one guy.
Yeah. So now it's when your opponent issues command command tokens off of a command card, they only get to issue one order.
I think this is way more powerful than you give it credit for. I think so.
I think it's good.
It's
in the right place.
This counters take that clankers. This counters tax strike. Entire legion, like you were just talking about. If someone's bringing that,
I mean, it.
There's so many things it counters.
Honestly, the best place for this card, though, is in the Rebel Mirror, because I think Empire has so many ways of turning one order into multiple orders, and Separatists do, and Clones do.
But most of our cards say orders that are from the commander.
Yes.
Unlike yours.
Well, and again, you're...
No, sure, but just like even the droid daisy chain, you just have to order a... Like your one order goes one.
Yeah.
But, I mean, but then the rest of the orders... The daisy chain, all the coordinate that Empire has, and it only stops orders from command cards.
Well, we don't have
so that. It doesn't stop Entourage, it doesn't stop uplinks, which are things the other factions
we don't have tend that much coordinate to take anymore. More of. And half of our shores just got way more expensive.
So,
not way more expensive.
Yeah, shores more expensive.
Shores more expensive.
Let's be honest.
Sure.
I mean, I get one.
But this also suffers from the Rebel command card problem. Why the hell am I taking a generic card when instead of just grabbing my six command cards, I have to pick from 12,
right?
Usually.
Yeah. And I will agree with that point.
He
has too many options. He can't be...
Yes.
This is not an option that'll never hit the table.
Like when you stack this up against...
commanders and two operatives.
Right.
I mean, like it's better than Rebellious.
Yeah.
But I don't know of another Rebel 1 pip that it's better than.
Right. Like, I don't think it... Yeah, so, I see what you're saying, and I agree with that point. Yeah, I agree with...
Better than R2-D2's one?
R2-D2's one can be pretty clutch. R2
one pip is like it can be really clutch.
I agree with that point, but again, I mean this card can just shut down. It's a cool card.
Don't get me wrong.
It shuts down Alpha Strike. Yeah. It shuts down Take That Clankers. Like it is so good. It's so good.
Yeah, that Tap Strike and Take That Clankers dropping is amazing. It really is.
Yeah.
Speaking of Rebel commanders with command cards, Jin cheaper.
Yep, 10 points.
Han much cheaper.
20 points, yep. That's not
unattainable. Han's back.
I'm glad he's at 100. I don't want him at 90. He's gross.
Yeah.
Han either needed to come down or get some more useful keywords.
No, get out of here. No.
No, one or the other. And I'm not saying both. I'm saying one or the other.
He's gross. At 100 is fine.
Yeah, I think I think 100's good.
Yeah. I would have maybe liked to seen him stay at like 110 and get a long shot.
God, no. Just bring Cassian.
Not with teamwork, yeah. I mean, we already give that to Cassian.
Speaking of, Chewie got a little cheaper again, which is great now that he's 90 points.
He got a lot of love, too. He got a lot of new keywords.
Yes, he did.
He got weird keywords, yeah. Because he didn't get duelist like his friends.
Right.
But he got the scalability and all that stuff. I actually think the Wookiee Warriors were changed a little bit more than he was.
Yeah.
He was nice.
But yeah, it's fine. And he gets lethal one on his four attack dice or four red die melee attack, which is great.
It's good for teamwork. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, it'll work out.
So yeah, Rebels got hit in most of the right places. Tauntauns did go up.
Yay!
So Ben got answer to his
rejoicing.
And we actually right, we had a great conversation.
Insert the dancing from Return of the Jedi.
So I had not played against Tauntauns since the update changes as to how they operated.
Yes.
Right.
So I will now, here on this podcast, episode 60, fully admit that they are not quite as OP as they once were.
Are you sure?
But they're still only 95 points. It only went up by 5 points. Why did they not go up to
even 100? I still have, there's still too many keywords.
I know.
They move too quick. They also get to throw dice, and RAM is incredibly overpowered.
I just ran into
a thing here. Please let me change some dice.
Yeah.
For 95 points, it's still cheaper than what it should be. But the movement changes do at least contain a bit of it. It is not the ping pong ball that used to just run across maps and hit everything that came with
it. Yeah.
No, so I will give it that it is slightly reduced.
Yeah. No.
But at 95 points and what it does,
I think all these changes as a whole were really good. And I think gives us a bright outlook for... Even with all the AMG shakeup things, like it, at least for where we're at right now, this lets us live in a new competitive environment. I think long enough for AMG to get its house in order, which is fine.
Yeah, come and make their mark and see what they're going to do with it. Yeah.
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 I will say on the Rebel, before we close out the Rebels here, I'm a little disappointed. FD laser cannons, other than the generator change, no love.
Boo-hoo.
I think they needed something.
They're range five.
I say they don't need the love either.
They're so good.
Boo-hoo.
70 points for a 5 black dice.
They're
range
so
one to 5
good.
Weapon.
I will take an ATRT over them or a Tauntaun over them any day of the week.
The snipers only throw 2 dice and they never hit anything because it's black and white.
Good.
This guy surges on everything. I mean, come on.
I would murder an Ewok, A, for fun, but B, just to get range 5, hell, to get range 4 on an E-Web.
Families of it.
On an,
it's got 6 health.
Yeah.
It's got 2 bravery. Like, I don't... And if for some reason you're not in the right front and you want to just throw 4 dice out the side, you can.
In order for me to get range 4 in my E-Web now, I basically got to put it on the back of a tank. And, you know, like...
And I agree with a lot of what you guys are saying, but the way the Rebels win games... This is a handicap because I need to take things that can move. I need to take things that can get on the board and do things instead of
you take a bid
choking on
your
bullshit
deployment zone.
Tim's trying to purge your hot take.
Oh, I know, exactly. I know he is.
It's not
if you
a hot
didn't
take,
pick maps, I'd
say,
if you were an 800 point rebel player, I'd say, all right, maybe. But you choose the deployment zones.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm with Tim.
All right. I think there are just better options for its cost. RTs, I wanted to see a little bit of help because I think the Republic RT for the same cost is just infinitely better.
Yeah. 10 points more.
Yeah.
For 10 points more, it gets critical one on its little rinky-dink gun, plus an extra die, plus scout, plus an extra die phase.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's still better even with 10 points more upcharge.
It's much, much better.
Much, much better.
So I was a little surprised.
Scout is so dumb on
it. ATRT love. Plus, like, Rebels have a hard time ordering vehicles. Like... I don't have all the cool tricks I can pull with my RTs like an Imperial player can
pull
with their
vehicles. That's because you don't build factories, you bomb them, you terrorists.
Yeah, you're right.
This is, all that's true.
Yeah.
He is not wrong.
And
your command, your entire faction is very hero-based small squad stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it is.
And Leia not getting any love. And I don't think she necessarily, I didn't think she needed much of it until Padme came along. But the fact that Padme does everything Leia does, but better for the exact same point cost.
Huh,
the
that only like thing my argument against Tauntauns and Dubens.
I know. The only thing that Leia does better, and I don't know that it's worth it, is she fulfills that commander requirement.
Yeah.
But I can't tell you the last time I played Leia as my only commander.
Right.
But her Inspire is also really good.
Her Inspire is good. Her Take Cover is incredibly good.
Yeah, it is.
Quick thinking with units that can share tokens and Leia or Padme's 2 pip that just absorbs all the suppression is infinitely better.
That's her 1 pip,
I'll give you that. I mean, I'm not saying lies about that. But
and like the standout aspect of Leia is her 2 pip that just can literally change games with letting people move. Padme gets that exact same thing on a faction that struggles to move.
Right.
No, I'm with you that I do think there should have been an adjustment to Leia, and it may have been going down. But you know, you slap that that scanner on her.
Yeah, she'll be out.
She's now got Take Cover 3.
She'll be fine.
Which is an appropriate use of it, you know.
Yeah.
Like binoculars in the Empire.
Yeah.
Get out.
binoculars is fine on Leia's counterpart, Veers, where you're just getting to do the thing you were doing already, but
much
more.
Better. Yeah, it'd be like putting scanners on Jyn.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
I mean, Take Cover 3 is really good. But I'm with you. Either her points come down, you add something.
And also that card isn't out yet, so maybe it'll be fine once the scanner goggles come out or whatever.
Portable.
So I don't know. I think Rebels got a lot of help out of this update. You know, the only bad thing we saw was Tauntauns going up, which is big whoop.
Yeah.
We knew it was going to happen.
It was.
And honestly, the Tauntauns didn't get hurt as much as I thought, because I thought may go down to 3 wounds.
That's what we said.
So
we said they should have been.
I still think they should have gone to 3 wounds.
Yeah,
100
in my
points.
Game against Keith, sure enough, every time I shot him, I'd get 3 wounds through. Not every time. I would get 3 wounds through, but not to kill the extra model.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then it would take me 4 or 5 shots to kill one of them.
Yep.
I mean,
every time.
Or to at least get to that extra one out. Because once they've moved, they add all the dodge tokens.
Right.
So
I shot him a Tauntaun with no dodge tokens. Still, only got 3 wounds because it surges on defense. I mean,
The funniest thing that happened, I think, in the entire update, though, is the MPL-57 Rebel Ion Trooper is now cheaper than a Z6. Like, we've just steadily watched that thing decrease in cost, decrease in cost, decrease in cost.
Still, and still no one's
I still don't know if I'm going to take it.
Nope. Because
no one is taking it.
Because a certain Athorian is still cheaper than that guy.
Right.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. I do love that Athorian, man.
And the problem is always going to be, one, it's just two red dice. It's exhaustible.
Yeah.
I mean, the impact one is cool, and the ion is also cool. But it's just nope.
It's that exhaust. Nope.
Yeah, you can't even just exhaust. You can't even bring it for a red just to add some reliable dice because it taps.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So,
but yes,
we've said all this about all of our various factions. We should say for the general neutral upgrades, lots of cool stuff got changed. Yeah. Reflexes got cheaper. A lot of gear went down in cost.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Neat. All neat stuff. Reflexes is the only one that really surprised me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Smoke grenade to 2 points is much more like much more where it should have been. People still aren't taking it because I don't like the rules on it.
Improvised at 5 points is now great.
That's value nice. Town.
Yep. That is a value town.
Yeah. Yes. Interesting was force guidance down to 5, which is fine, but
it's where it should have been.
It's where it should be.
I mean, hell.
But it's still.
You could make force guidance free.
Yeah.
And I still don't know that you take correct. It.
The problem is timing. It's all timing.
Timing. But, yeah.
Well, it's time. It's timing, and it takes a slot. Like, who has a slot left over to just hand out a surge token?
Some people most. Do, but
not most. I mean,
some.
Stims are down 2 points. They're now down to 10 points. Even.
Yep. They're back in the conversation. Like,
yeah, perhaps they're coming back.
They went from 8 to 12, right. And now in the middle at 10.
Environment mind trick down 2.
Yeah.
Down 2.
Mind trick got a reword. And maybe it was more of a problem than in other places than it was in our meta. But now Mind Trick, I don't know that I ever take it now that I can't hit your commanders or operatives with it.
I like the change.
It's yeah.
I don't know if it was a problem around here.
It's fine. Yeah.
So yeah, it kind of surprised me. So,
But it makes sense thematically. I mean, they're not weak-minded people.
Right.
Exactly.
So, right.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm in favor of
unless,
it.
Unless it's Krennic, then he's weak-minded. It's like his whole plot arc.
Yep.
So who won the update?
Empire.
Empire. I agree with that. Empire.
Yeah, it was the Empire. Yeah, it was totally the Empire.
I mean, don't worry. A lot of your stuff went down, Ryan. I don't know if it changes a lot of play.
It doesn't.
Opens up the Empire so much more to more options.
Yeah.
Than they're used to
prepping against Empire lists got so much more difficult while my units just kind of got where they needed to be back on the menu at all. I don't know. Empire's looking real strong.
Yeah.
But it's refreshing to not know just we knew the hierarchy of the game for a while and now it's right. Like I don't know who's going to be on top. Like it's maybe Empire, maybe clones are still good enough. Like I don't know.
I still think clones are good enough, but I think Empire is now in that
spot. But we don't know. There.
Yeah.
And me and the CIS will fight at the bottom.
No, I think CIS is fine.
So Rebels are still, after the update, Rebels are still the weakest?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think it's...
Oh, I think they are.
No.
No, I don't think you're the weakest. I'm still missing key components to allow my faction the flexibility.
My faction still has downsides, so until it doesn't, it is unacceptable.
Yeah. Well, January, you'll be a full-fleshed out faction when you have your generic commander.
So speaking of looking forward to things... There were a couple things that were in this update that that have not been mentioned elsewhere and that are new, and we have not had any more clarification other than what is in update. So things like contingencies.
What is that card or that keyword, I guess it's not a card.
Yeah.
I am that has to be a rebel thing, right?
It fits the archetype.
Maybe.
Because we have more command cards than sense.
Stupid shenanigans. Yes, check.
Yeah.
I have all of these extra cards I'm going to hold over here on my sideboard.
Yeah.
Keep your tableau ready.
Yeah.
I think, so for those of you who haven't read this in the book since it hasn't shown up anywhere, it lets you set aside, contingency will have a number associated with it, lets you set aside that many command cards. And after you reveal command cards, you can substitute the command cards you played by discarding, so you don't get it back like change of plans.
Yeah.
With one of your set aside command cards that has the same pip value.
Yeah. Great.
If this isn't a rebel keyword, I'm going to be really sad because we are the ones with too many command cards. But it's super cool.
We're all getting up there soon. We're all getting up there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to start playing character ball here in a minute.
So interestingly, also on the same note of new things coming up, is direct which is basically Entourage, but without the list building side. It's
Diet Entourage.
Yes, Entourage or Less Steps.
Which, oh, it's kind of unfortunate because I actually wish we had the other way around. I need more slots. I want more slots. I'll figure out the orders later. There's other command cards and other things I can do to make the orders happen. I just want more slots.
Here's my hot take. I don't think you have to worry about it, Tim. If Empire gets more stuff like this, I think Entourage is going to be an Imperial keyword. I'm expecting Direct to go to one of the prequel factions. It doesn't feel like a rebel
Lando
thing.
Lando to his Cloud City Troopers.
Yes.
I don't think he'll get Cloud City Troopers.
He's going to direct his love bot. Yeah. So.
His love bot.
So.
Lobot.
I don't know, but as much as I would love that, the downside of rebels have always been our bag control.
Right.
Like, we are chaotic by nature.
Yes.
As you should be.
I could see this being a CIS keyword to units that don't have coordinate on them.
No.
So you might get something with like direct AAT or direct BX droids.
I think you're going to see it in a lot of places, and I think it opens up a lot of ground for it. I think it's a lot of, it gives you a lot of like upgrade options. Like this card gives you direct blah, blah, blah. You know,
it does feel like FFG was listening to our conversation last week when I was like, why are you guys not bringing all four special forces?
Right.
Like, I still don't understand that.
But right.
Like, all right, we'll just take away that option.
Yeah. and then also, speaking of special things, you have Wookiees in there. Wookiees have their own clarification as Wookiee troopers.
Troopers.
They're not just troopers.
I read it like four times trying to look for what it actually does, and I didn't see
it. No,
it very clearly does nothing.
It does nothing yet. But you could get
it's future proofing.
Tartuffle. Yeah. The Italian dessert.
Yeah. So yeah, it tells us that Wookiee troopers are a thing, and Wookiee troopers are just like troopers, except they are Wookiees.
Yeah.
Or you could get Lumpy from the holiday special.
Oh, get out!
Yes.
No. No, please.
Lumpy and Itchy and Mala.
I mean. Will we get Chewbacca's wife?
Yeah.
A woman who's just been at home knitting while Chewbacca's off in these...
I need the four-armed...
when will my husband come back from the war?
When will he come back from the war?
When will...
He has never returned.
I knitted him a sweater.
Be a thing? That's...
Oh.
Yeah.
I kind of need a Chewbacca-based odyssey now. You know? Him coming home with his troops, getting caught there.
His son is there waiting.
Suitors for Chewbacca's wife. I mean... I'm down for this literary adventure.
You must string the bowcaster to prove that you are him.
I mean, we are getting towards Christmas.
Will gets it. Will
gets it. He has to get the golden Wookiee fleece.
I am cultured.
Yes. Yeah. When Will starts thinking he's cultured, it's time to end our show.
Oh, my God.
And to run away. Jesus, you guys won't let me sign out?
No.
Oh, help us. God help me. I'm taking applications to be on other people's podcasts at this point.
We saw your.
Thanks everybody for listening.
We saw your exchange. We saw what you said. It's fine.
Thanks everybody for spending your drive time, your paint time, whatever it is you bother to listen to us. Thanks for tuning in. I lost my train of thought.
You're saying goodbye, next time, Ryan.
I'm Ryan Slowoski, reminding you that concussion grenades are just 3 points now, and I'm excited.
I'm Will High, reminding you not to fall asleep during the episode like I did during this one.
I'm Tim, reminding you, I need more than three support slots. I need support slots. Give me more support slots, please.
And I'm Ben Fowler, reminding you, hey guys, it's all fine. It's going to be a great game. We just have fun playing with each other. Good night, everybody.
That's a weird.
Have a good night, folks.
That's a weird way to say clones to Linda Est.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I mean, clones still need to be destroyed. Don't get me wrong. I'm still aiming for that goal. But, you know, in this time of Thanksgiving and anxiety in the world, it'll be okay.
In a horrible twist of irony, they need to be purged. Hey.
Rude.
Good night, everybody.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Bye. Bye. You already said goodbye. I forgot.
Tim, are you one of those people like don't cancel student debt because I paid off my debt?
No.
Yeah.
No, not at all. Not at all. That's a separate issue. We won't go there.